Michael, great stuff. We appreciate it. And we welcome you to Philadelphia and the American Conference on ESPN. Yeah, 76ers, Flyers, the Eagles have a big game on Sunday. Sometimes they bury the Temple Owls. But right now, Temple is in a stretch of a couple of seasons where they're ready to make history. They're only a couple of wins away from going to bowl games in back-to-back seasons for the first time in program history. And tonight, they have maybe their toughest task of the year as they bring in the South Florida Bulls, who are undefeated. We've got the top two teams in the Eastern Division in the American Conference, and the next three weekends are going to be huge in deciding who ends up in the conference championship game. Willie Taggart, Matt Rhule, two guys in their early 40s who are both doing great things in their fourth seasons. Willie Taggart and the Bulls trying to get to 7-1 for the first time in program history. And with that, we happily welcome you on a Friday night into the broadcast booth. Adam Amin, Mac Brown, Molly McGrath will join us in a moment as well. So we've told you why this game is important. Let's dive into one of the stars, Quentin Flowers of South Florida, arguably one of the best in the country, dual threat-wise.
Folks, we saw Lamar Jackson a couple of weeks ago. Yep. He was fun. This guy tonight is going to be a lot like him. Quentin Flowers is one of the best running quarterbacks in the country, but he can throw it deep, which you can see there as he throws it deep to Adams. And they have a lot of speed and tools. When we start looking at what Willie Taggart said last year, I don't want you to be a leader. Quentin, I just want you to run the ball and run the offense. Well, this year, he's asking him to lead as well. So he's got confidence, he's being smart, one of the best guys around.
Well, Mac, as you were saying, Quentin Flowers attributes his success to a newfound calm and confidence that he first experienced at the beginning of this season after Coach Willie Taggart pointed out that the quarterback allowed himself to get emotionally hijacked in big game moments. Now Flowers is focused on staying locked in and even keel no matter what happens, not only refusing to get outwardly upset when he makes a mistake, but also limiting his celebrations after a big play. And as you mentioned, Coach Taggart said this is the first year that he's actually asked Flowers to lead, saying he's grown up, and as a result, our entire team has grown up. Guys?
We'll wait to see Quentin Flowers as South Florida won the toss and deferred, so Temple will get the ball to start this night, sitting at 2-1 in the American Athletic Conference Eastern Division. Jagger Gardner will be back to return, along with Randall Jones and Emilio Nadelman, redshirt junior out of Miami, who's been a very good place kicker for South Florida, will start us off. Huge action on a Saturday, and we've got a doubleheader on a Friday night, Pac-12 after dark, after we're done here. And we started off with the American Conference, and out to the 25-yard line will come Philip Walker, no longer known as PJ. He's graduated from that. He's more mature. He's the senior from Elizabeth, New Jersey, the winningest starting quarterback in Temple history. He's passed Henry Burris for all the big marks, passing yards, touchdowns, making his 41st career start all consecutively. And you see the record books that he has been able to top over the course of this season and over his career, where he's been a mainstay at this very important position for a Temple offense that is very versatile. On first down, they'll swing it out to Broderick Yancey in space, and he'll pick up 6 yards to start off the night. Mac on this side of the ball, Nick Sharga. We don't really talk about the fullback a whole lot. We have to with Temple.
Well, Temple's going to run the ball, and it's going to be led by Nick Sharga. He's a fullback that was a walk-on, was a scout team defensive end. Guy's got a 3.86 grade point average kinesiology, so he should be able to figure out who to block. As we look at the defense, you got 43, Augie Sanchez, middle linebacker, 13 tackles against Syracuse last week.
Top tackler in the American Conference, tied at the top with Eric Wilson of Cincinnati. Jahad Thomas, one of two very impressive running backs, takes it for a couple and sets up a third down and about two here for the Temple offense, which is averaging 32 points per game. That's seventh in a 12-team American Conference. When they run the ball, they're really good. And when Jahad Thomas runs it, he does big things.
And they're going to huddle up and slow this thing down. They're not going to be the fast tempo that will be on the other side with South Florida.
Raquel Armstead is the other back. He gets the toss, and he gets the conversion. Has the first down across the 35, and he picked up 5 to move the chains.
A very good block by Nick Sharga, because he is our impact player, and he's going to be leading this tailback in the eye all night. He's tough, he's smart, and he and Sanchez are going to have a lot of contact tonight up inside of that line of scrimmage.
Or Matt Rhule, who has improved every single year. They were bowl eligible at 6-6 in 2014, but did not go. They matched a program record with 10 wins last year and trying to make bowl games in back-to-back seasons for the first time in their program's history. A bullet caught by Ventel Bryant in space. And Bryant shifts to the outside, and a big play gets him inside the South Florida 35-yard line.
It's really good, Adam. When everybody knows you're going to come out and run the ball, and you come out and throw two of the first three times. Smart throw on the slant. Smart call. Easy completion. Got South Florida's defense on their heels a little bit on the first drive.
32-yard pickup there. And it's first down and 10 at the 33. Ventel Bryant, big on that final wild drive. A comeback win in the final 30 seconds last week against UCF. Jahad Thomas, not much room there. Good chase down by Dietrich Nichols out on the perimeter. Matt Rhule getting after his tight end and his blocker in Colin Thompson.
Well, in talking to the Temple coaches, they felt like South Florida was much more physical than them last year and just absolutely whipped them. So Matt has talked about Temple tough all week, and you guys better bring it tonight and not be embarrassed like you were at this time last year.
Already,
so he is getting after it.
Already getting after it on the sidelines. Isaiah Wright is a receiver, but they like to use him in the running game. They handed it off, but a false start penalty.
False start. Offense, number 89. 5-yard penalty. Take it down.
That is Keith Kirkwood, who had the game-winning touchdown reception at the end of the game against UCF last week. Willie Taggart has done very well. Did a great job ending his tenure at his alma mater, Western Kentucky. And when you give Willie Taggart some time, he knows how to turn a program up. That's been the case so far at South Florida after a good year last year. There's Bryant on the tunnel screen with blockers. And Ventel Bryant gets all of that penalty yardage back and nearly picks up the first down. He's down to the 25-yard line where Tajay Fullwood met him after a 14-yard pickup.
Well, and the offensive coordinator, Glenn Thomas, came in from the Falcons. He brought in some new concepts, got the tunnel screen up inside, and Bryant makes a big gain to put it back to third and down and one. Really good play selection early in this ball game from Thomas.
Last week, Temple did not have a lead until they scored that 19th touchdown of the season in 32 possessions. With 1 second to go, they got the touchdown to Kirkwood to beat UCF.
Timeout. Temple.
And here they'll take a timeout, talk things over on a third down and short. We'll step aside too. We're 4 minutes in. Last week, UCF took an 8-0 lead in the first minute and a half on Temple. They trailed 25-7 with 3 minutes left in the first half and then scored 19 unanswered points, including the game-winning touchdown with a second to go on a 70-yard drive to beat UCF. Tonight, trying to make it back-to-back wins after two wild games in a row. And on third down and one, Nick Sharga on his seventh career carry, the fullback, will keep the offense on the field for the Owls.
Adam, right now, everything's working exactly like the Temple coaches wanted to. They've already taken off 4 minutes. They haven't had but one penalty because they said penalties have been stopping their drives, and they're staying on the field and keeping that South Florida speed on the bench.
South Florida, an exceptionally explosive offense. The Temple wants to establish the run, hold on to that football. Armstead still in the game as the tail of the tandem here, and Philip Walker in such control of this offense in no hurry. Here is Armstead off the tackle. That's a head of steam run and a good one on first down. Down to the 17-yard line. Dietrich Nichols, the corner, stopped him after five.
These backs are tough, and they're just going to keep pounding them at them. They got a big, strong offensive line. Back up to the line of scrimmage quickly.
They're a versatile offense, multiple looks, multiple personnel packages. They had to throw it against Memphis in a 7-point loss. They had to run it against UCF. They can do both. Good block by Sharga and another strong run by Armstead for four to set up third down and short.
I really like Armstead. He's a slasher. He's 205 pounds. He's averaging about 5.7 yards and Sharga. He gets out there and knocks them down. He's a great leader, but I love the way the back makes yards after contact.
So Armstead steps off after two good runs, and now Jahad Thomas is back out on the field. They've been on schedule setting up third down and shorts on this drive. And Thomas, with another lead block from Sharga, has the first down. It'll be first down and goal for Temple. Again, we don't highlight the fullback in college football all that much anymore, but this guy is making impacts early on blocks.
He's a special young man. He went to West Virginia Wesleyan, and he transfers in here as a walk-on. He's on the scout team. They actually gave him that number, a special number, before he even got on scholarship.
We'll talk about the single-digit numbers, a tradition that Matt Rhule has brought back, but you have to earn your way to a single-digit number. Sharga earned it without playing a snap in an official game for Temple. He's the lead blocker once again for Thomas. And Jahad Thomas, who has scored 2+ touchdowns in each of the last 5 games, runs it for 4 yards, and Nate Godwin on the stop. It's second down and goal.
Well, there's no one that's going to question why we got Sharga as the impact player, Adam, because as we start this game, it's another sweep. He goes out and knocks Nichols on his back. So he is such a physical player. He's fun to watch. And for all you young guys out there that nobody wants you, do what this guy's done. Go somewhere, walk on, and make your own name. Special player.
Almost 7 minutes off the clock to start the night for Temple, trying to keep South Florida's offense on the sideline. Here is Thomas, another Sharga block, and Thomas dives ahead inside the 5. It'll be third down and goal here for Temple, which has scored on 29 of 32 red zone possessions this year. That's very good, but the touchdown rate is under 60%. That's not as good. They need to cash in here.
And they've got to score touchdowns tonight because they know with the speed of South Florida, they're going to score theirs. So these guys are doing exactly what they want to do. Be physical, stay on the field, kill the clock, beat the South Florida defense down, but they've got to get 7.
It's been 6 straight run plays for Walker and the Owls. And now a pass play on the fade, looking to the corner, and it is incomplete. They were looking for Roman Deloach, the tight end, and Danny Thomas had him in coverage at the linebacker spot.
They were trying to throw the fade. Deloach is a big guy at 6'4", and they had him matched up on the linebacker, which is exactly what they wanted. Deloach is a tight end. He's kind of a hybrid guy, but they had it perfectly set up. Obviously, the fans wanted the interference call. I thought it was a no call. Throw was just too high.
So after Austin Jones, the 3-year kicker, went down against Memphis with a torn ACL, Aaron Boomery, they call him Boom Boom, the freshman, has gone 2-for-2 on field goals. And he stays clean from 23 yards out, the true freshman out of Phillipsburg, Pennsylvania. A long Temple drive ends in 3, and Willie Taggart's explosive offense gets the ball when you come back.
We are back here in Philadelphia for USF Temple, and I'm here with a special guest, the commissioner of the American Athletic Conference, Mike Oresko. And Mike, with the Big 12 deciding not to expand, how do you as a conference keep viable teams and be a viable place for teams to stay in the conference and be a competitive place?
Well, Molly, it's been a good conference for our schools. What we have to do now is continue to be competitive. We'll regroup and refocus very quickly. We have a P6 narrative, a Power 6 narrative that we're going to resume as a conference, and we feel that in the end, this is a good place to be. You know, our schools are very committed. We've got a great group. They feel a real camaraderie. This was a tough process. It really was. We all know that. But they got through it, and I think they got through it with sensitivity toward each other and the conference office. So I think we've got a lot to build on now. And remember, over the last 6 months, we've probably gotten more good publicity in many ways, ironically. You know, it's been tough, but it also gave us a lot of publicity because we're the schools that the P5 look to, and that showed, it shined a light on how competitive we are. If we keep doing what we're doing, we'll be fine.
If a group of 5 school remains undefeated, do they deserve to make it into the playoff?
Oh, I think an undefeated or a one-loss group of 5 teams, especially our teams, we have been a very strong conference, as you know. We've won a lot of P6 games, or 5 games. That was a Freudian slip, P6. But the P5 games, we've won 16 over the last 2 years. And you saw what we did in the Fiesta Bowl a few years ago, what we did in the Peach Bowl. So I think that teams like ours and others, if they have those kinds of records, should absolutely be considered. And I know the committee will consider strength of schedule, but if you play a really good non-conference schedule, I think you deserve that consideration, yes.
All right, thank you, Mike. Adam, back to you.
Molly, thanks for having me.
We really appreciate Mike Oresko taking the time with Molly here tonight. We'll dive into those notes in just a second here as Quinton Flowers and the South Florida offense, which has been one of the most explosive in the country, goes to work. And looking for Rodney Adams, that play is blown up by Nate Hairston. Rodney Adams is a slot man, and Nate Hairston was there to read that play as Quinton Flowers will have third down and four here, already being considered one of the best players in South Florida history, 15-6 as a starter. Those 655 rushing yards are second in the conference. And they go quarterback design run for Flowers with a penalty marker thrown. He moves the chains. We'll have to check that flag from the offensive backfield back at the 40-yard line. And our official tonight is Todd LaPenta.
Personal foul. Legal block below the waist. Offense, number 73. 15-yard penalty. Go down.
Jeremy Hall was blocking back towards the line of scrimmage, so it is a penalty, and that'll be third down and long. And Willie Taggart runs the Gulf Coast offense. That's what he calls it. It's up-tempo. It's spread. He's got a lot of weapons, and it's a scary offense. Eighth in the country right now in total offense and scoring.
And he's going to spread you out wide. He's going to show a lot of formations early, see how you adjust to it. He's going to go as fast as he can, and he calls those plays. I love that play call. They did have the penalty, but it's four wide receivers out with a quarterback draw. Get everybody out of the box. You get him running against fewer numbers. He's really dangerous.
Well, Temple plays its safeties back towards the sticks, and South Florida goes draw with Marlon Mack, the all-time leading rusher in South Florida history. He'll only get to the 43-yard line as Roman Deloach, who plays both ways for Temple, is there for the stop. 13-yard gain, and it's fourth down.
And Adam, the Temple fans might be mad. Coach Snow just backed off. Let him have 15 yards. Doesn't matter. It's third down. You kept them short of the chains, make them punt, get the ball back.
So Jahad Thomas is back to return. He's had a kick return touchdown in his career. John Hernandez, the Florida State transfer, will avoid Thomas, get that one out of bounds despite some pressure. And that'll take us to a timeout of the field. 5:35 to play here in Philadelphia, opening quarter.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by the Lincoln Motor Company and the exhilarating new Lincoln MKZ. And Philadelphia cream cheese. Nothing else tastes like Philadelphia.
They call this the rampage drill. They got loose, they get tough before the game. That's what Temple likes to do before their game. They want to bring back the Temple toughness. And they've done that by giving out single-digit numbers to the 10 toughest guys on the team. You have to earn that number. That's a tradition that Matt Rhule has brought back to his days at Temple. Nick Sharga, one of those guys. Philip Walker, one of those guys, hands to Isaiah Wright for a big gain, but a late penalty marker comes in from the offensive backfield. Second drive for Temple after a very solid opening drive that took a lot of time off the clock and ended with 3 points.
Personal foul. Tripping. Offense, number five. Half this is the goal. First down.
Jahad Thomas got tagged with a tripping penalty. This is a point of emphasis for officials this season. They missed one last night in that BYU-Boise State game that could have been crucial, but that is a point of emphasis for officials this year.
And Adam, the Temple coaches told us yesterday, the offensive coaches and Coach Rhule, when we don't have penalties, we score points. Penalties on offense have killed us. Giving up explosive plays on defense has killed us, and that's their second offensive penalty already tonight.
Well, it sets up first down back at the 10-yard line. And they'll swing it out to Thomas, and good penetration by South Florida's defense to force Jahad Thomas all the way to the other side of the field. And he still turns it into a gain, and Nigel Harris finally caught up to him at the 18. After an 8-yard run, felt like he went 30 yards to get those eight.
Yeah, it's really good penetration by Mike Love, number 98. They read the play perfectly, then they over-pursue, and Thomas turns it up the other side. Really good play by Nigel Harris to run him down. Shows you the ability and the skill of both of these football teams in space.
And they'll move Isaiah Wright. Quick pocket collapsing against Philip Walker, and he still turned it into a gain. Got hit from behind by Kirk Livingston, the redshirt freshman. And it sets up third down at about 10 here.
And Philip Walker's not a guy that likes to run the ball like Quentin Flowers, but he can. He can do a good job with it. And we've heard a lot about that defensive line at South Florida and Kirk Livingston that time making the play. And because of the penalty, Adam, we're back to third and 10.
I was just thinking the same
thing. Instead of the short yardage where they want to be on third down.
That's where they were on that opening drive. A lot of third and short situations. Against a four-man rush, looking for Kirkwood. And Kirkwood is there. He's got the first down out across the 45-yard line, absorbing the Godwin hit for 24 yards.
What a perfect throw. It's too deep coverage. You've got the corner rolled up on him. The safety over the top. It's a double move where he fakes the slant. He goes out deep. He catches the ball right inside of Nate Godwin, the safety. Perfect throw from quarterback Walker.
So now they go back to that I formation. Like we said, multiple personnel groupings, multiple looks. They go back to the power formation in the I. Armstead is the back, and he gets the fake. Walker with another penalty marker thrown, able to extend the play and throw incomplete downfield. We'll have to check this flag. Busy start for Todd LaPenta and his crew tonight.
Holding offense, number 53, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Leon Johnson, the right tackle in his 25th career game, got tagged with that penalty. So another first and 20.
Just can't keep stopping themselves. They've been running the ball so well on first down out of the eye. They've got the play action. Coach Rhule's getting all over him right now. And of course, then you get on the official when he says, I didn't touch anybody. And then they start talking about, well, he gave me the wrong call, coach. And none of that matters. Don't hold. Backed up again, first and 20.
And now Jalen Robinson checks in as the right tackle for Johnson, who just got called for that penalty. A quick change up front. Still Temple taking a lot of time off the clock. And on first down, Armstead gets ripped down by Livingston. Pre-med coming into South Florida. He's got offers from everywhere in the conference, and he comes to the Bulls, to this Bull Shark defense.
He's really quick. He takes an outside step and then a swim move up inside for penetration to stop the running game. You cannot give up penetration and run the football.
You saw that move he made towards his helmet. That's the Bull Shark move, the 4-2-5 defense that Tom Allen implemented. Right tackle again.
Correction. Defensive outside. Number 98, causing the offensive player to react. 5-yard penalty. Take it down.
Mike Love drew Jalen Robinson into movement. So Love gets tagged with the offsides. So add 5 yards. And as you mentioned, with already 2.5 minutes to go, Temple is possessing the football, keeping the explosive offense of Willie Taggart out on the sidelines.
They're letting it run as much as they can.
You got Brian at the top of that formation, as you saw.
Let the clock run.
Blitz coming. Forces Walker with an errant throw, and Armstead could not corral it in space. Guy who's only got 5 receptions out of the backfield in his career. A good pressure play by South Florida with Nigel Harris coming up the middle.
Yes, he's one of their better blitzers. He's an undersized guy, but he can really run. So when you get Nigel Harris in space, he can work up to the line of scrimmage, work back, but he can sure go attack the quarterback.
I really like the linebacking talent with Sanchez and Harris, a couple of upperclassmen who have been very good. They're top two tacklers on this team. A position linebacker that at South Florida has a rich history in just 20 years as a football program. Well, on third down and long, another penalty marker comes flying in. This one for a false start. Matt Rhule is going to be furious.
Prior to the play, false start. Offense. Number 11, 5-yard penalty, third down.
Well, Adam, you mentioned Augie Sanchez. He told me that their linebacker core prides themselves by their toughness and physicality, saying that it starts with the example set by Coach Steven Nicholas, who's a former USF All-Conference linebacker who spent 7 years in the NFL. Sanchez called Nicholas a mentor that the players relate to and respect, saying this school's seen so many respectful linebackers, and Coach Nicholas makes us appreciate our history and tries to mold us into what they were.
Walker under pressure, throws it up for grabs for Thomas, hoping he'd grab it and run in space. And Molly, guess who? Nigel Harris with the pressure once again on Walker, forcing the tough throw.
Nigel comes from that weak side. He's only 6 foot, 225 pounds, but he can really, really run. They had a little X stun inside with the two inside linemen changing gaps and trying to get him some confusion there. Nigel comes from the outside, hits the quarterback as he throws it, and disrupts the screen.
So the linebacking corps active to force the punt. And Alex Starzik, wild snap, shanks one on the ground. A squib punt that still gets some decent roll to get it inside the 35.
And South Florida did a good job of getting away from that ball, because many times when they kick it, it's going to hit the backside of one of those South Florida players. Good job by them being alert.
Instead, a 35-yard kick. Well, since 1900, only two teams in major college football have won 21 consecutive road games. That's what Ohio State is trying to do at a place that they haven't been all that successful. 6-5 in Happy Valley since Penn State joins the Big Ten in 1993. Saturday Night Football from Penn State, the alma mater of Temple's head coach Matt Rhule, tomorrow night, 8 Eastern on ABC with Chris, Kirk, and Sam. We get to see JT Barrett go back to work tomorrow night, the new touchdown record holder for Ohio State. Out of that quad receiver set, out of the pack comes Marlon Mack, the all-time leading rusher in South Florida history. Catches and runs that one into Temple territory for 19 yards.
And they're going to go fast. They've only had three plays in this first quarter until that one. Had the ball 95 seconds till that snap. They've got to stay on the field here some.
Again, they spread the field once again for Flowers, who runs it near side. And Flowers to the sticks. He's got the first down at the 40. And there's an injured South Florida Bull back behind the play. That looked like Tyree McCants.
That was actually going to be a quarterback counter to the left, and it wasn't blocked. They gave up penetration, so he bounces it out to the right to show you what this guy can do with off-schedule plays.
McCants puts up the thumbs up, lets his teammates know he's all right. Darnell Salomon, the freshman, will come out there for him.
Mom needs to know he's all right, too. She's watching closely. They like that thumbs up.
Rysheen Bronson, very good receiver for the South Florida team, is out tonight with a shoulder injury that he's been dealing with since
James
last week.
Got hung up on the sideline. It's second down and one.
They'll spot him at the 40-yard line. The marker seemingly was at the 40. It should be at the 39, and that's where it is. So it's second down and one. Out of that quad set once again, Flowers looking for somebody to come back to the ball, and it ends up going to the Temple sideline looking for Rodney Adams. Third down and short coming up. We talked about Marlon Mack, but De'Ernest Johnson's very important too, Matt.
When we talked to Coach Taggart, he thought number two running back De'Ernest Johnson was the best football player on his team. We'll see him touch it in a lot of different ways tonight. And to stop Quentin Flowers has to be number seven defensive end Hassan Riddick. He's one of the best pass rushers in the country because of his get off. And we'll be watching him chase Quentin all night, Adam.
And watch him. He's at the bottom of the line right now. He does not have his hand down. He leads the country in tackles for loss. He leads the conference in sacks. Zone read. They give it to Mack, who burrows for the first down. Marlon Mack, over 3,100 yards in his career at South Florida, the all-time leading rusher. 26 touchdowns, 17 100-yard games. He's got all the records. Put up a monster 2015 season. And he is on the perimeter now and in space. He's able to slip one tackle and get close to the sticks. Finally brought down by Stephon Marshall, but As we approach a half minute to go here in this first quarter, South Florida is getting closer and closer to the end zone.
They're spreading them out. They're going fast.
Five wide set. Flowers has a lot of space to keep this play alive. Flowers wants it all, has a man, touchdown, Marquez Valdez-Scantling. There's only so long you can hold up until he finds somebody.
He's gonna fake the screen and try to go deep. Nothing's there. It's a four-man rush. You've got to keep contained, Temple. You can't let this guy get outside the tackle box. Easy throw for a touchdown. That's what he does to beat you, and you can see why Temple's trying to keep him on the boundary.
So after a three and out on the opening drive, South Florida picks up the tempo, picks up the speed, picks up big chunks of yards to go down the field in just six plays and less than a minute 20. Nadelman is on for the extra point. And the South Florida Bulls, one of the most explosive offenses in college football, march down to take a 7-3 lead.
That guy's spread out all over the field, pumps a quick screen that he's been hitting, looks deep down the middle, nobody's there, backside end, loses containment, he comes inside, Flowers moves to the right for the easy throw for the touchdown.
A 27-yarder to the transfer from North Carolina State, already three touchdowns this season in his first year with South Florida, and Quinton Flowers picks up right where he left off the last couple of weeks.
These guys can score so fast. They're fun to watch. They've got so many guys that when they touch the ball, they have a chance to score. Well, Temple's best chance is to stay on the field and not let these guys have a lot of time on offense.
South Florida is on pace for its best offensive season in program history. They're great in the red zone. They're great scoring. They're great on the ground. They're great on fourth down. They have a good offensive line, which has only given up eight sacks. All the numbers are in their favor on offense. Good kick bounced out past Randall Jones and out to the 25. Will come Temple late in the first. So we've got some huge games coming up for you across the ESPN networks tomorrow. So while you're sitting on your couch, you can get your laptop out, you can get your phone out. Download the ESPN app or watch ESPN. Go to watchESPN.com, and you'll be able to watch multiple games as the day goes on. You'll get to see Louisville and Lamar Jackson, who's leading the Heisman Trophy run right now in terms of the voting among all the Heisman voters at ESPN. SEC West doubleheader on ESPN. And don't forget Alabama, Texas A&M, the set of game day tomorrow.
West Virginia's undefeated.
Absolutely.
West
Probably
Virginia,
not getting
TCU,
enough love, right?
Be fun.
Here is Wright on the run, and he spins back towards the middle. Good run. And Isaiah Wright churning for 11 yards and a first down. Excellent job by the freshman out of West Hartford, Connecticut. And that'll take us likely to the end of this first quarter. Temple got out physicaled in this meeting last year. That's what the coaching staff told us. They want to be on the field. They want to grind out drives against the big time maneuvering of Mack and Flowers in the South Florida offense. Through one in Philly. Game one of a doubleheader tonight as South Florida in front. Just the third meeting all time between South Florida and Temple. The two teams at the top of the American Athletic Conference Eastern Division. The next few weekends are going to decide a whole lot as to what's going to happen at the end of the year. These next three weekends not only have divisional championship implications in this conference, but potential New Year's Six implications as well, with teams like Navy, South Florida, all in the mix right now, as well as Houston. On first down, Philip Walker down the sideline, and he overthrows Roman Deloach, his two-way target who plays tight end on offense. That'll bring up second down.
That's good coverage by Johnny Ward. Johnny, they call the old man. He's the old guy, as he's been around so long. But one thing that has to happen tonight is this bunch has to have ball control for Temple. They had the ball 20 snaps to 9 in the first quarter, and you can't give up the pass on first down and not hit it. They've got to make the first down completions.
Swing it out for Isaiah Wright on his first career catch. The freshman who's been used much more out of the wildcat and as a running back from the slot, he takes it for a first down. First career grab for the freshman out of West Hartford.
Isaiah Wright, 6'2", 207. He's really a smart football player, and these guys like him. He's very, very mature. Get the ball quickly in his hands. We call it a bubble screen. One-on-one blocking outside. The guy's big, strong, and fast. He could be an impact in this game tonight.
They do rule that as a forward pass, so it is the first career catch for Wright, who could be explosive from multiple spots. And he's in motion once again. Counterplay for the back in Armstead, with a penalty marker flying in from the defensive backfield.
Holding offense, number 55. 10-yard penalty, first down.
Brian Carter, right guard, who's been a starter in his career, and now that's five accepted penalties against Temple's offense, something that Matt Rhule very much emphasized yesterday that they cannot afford.
And you can see that Matt's so frustrated. Every time one of those young linemen has a penalty, he jerks him out of the game and says, we can't have this. We can't put ourselves with our offensive style in first down and 20.
Pac-12 After Dark coming up on ESPN. Oregon and Cal, both teams coming off a bye. Let's get weird after this game. Walker under pressure once again. And they're going to blow this play dead as Jawan Brown got a little aggressive, and that's how we see those penalty markers come and fly in after the play.
After the play, personal foul, defense, unnecessary roughness, number 56, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
So you got to play to the whistle, but you can't play through the whistle.
Absolute killer, and especially when it's the quarterback. You cannot have that penalty. You've got them backed up. You've got them in trouble. And Jawan Brown just slings him down to the ground. You got to take care of the quarterbacks. When you hear the whistle, you can't have the extra tug and throw him down. They're going to call it every time.
It would have been second down and 27. Instead, it's a fresh set of downs at the 44-yard line for Temple's offense, which stays on the field. And Nick Sharga is back in there as a fullback in that power set.
When he's in there, they're going to run the power plays or they're going to have play action. That's it.
Sharga gets another block on the perimeter for Armstead, who on first down gets a great run. We've seen that so many times when Sharga's on the field tonight. Got a big block to open things up.
Those tailbacks yesterday said they love following Sharga.
It's a different cat, man. It's a different cat. That's what they said about Sharga yesterday.
He doesn't even care about carrying the ball. He just wants to run over people.
He does have a conversion tonight on a short run play. That was just his seventh run play. Seventh career carry tonight.
We used to call that a treat to a fullback.
It looked like Armstead just lost his footing and ends up setting up third down and about four here, about three and a half. But Sharga is out of Cherryville, Pennsylvania. He's one of 11 kids. He spent 2013 at Division II West Virginia Wesleyan, transfers to Temple, redshirts in 14, works his tail off as part of the scout team, and earns that single-digit number. Jahad Thomas says he's the hardest worker on the team. They rib him a little bit for the long and curly hair and, you know, kind of an odd duck at times, but he's a big-time cog in this offense. Walker with a wide open man for a first down. It's Bryant for the big play once again. And he's down to the South Florida 30-yard line. 19 yards. Interesting play call on third down and short.
It's what Temple does best. They fake the power play. They come off of it. Sharga goes underneath in the flat to clear it out. And first down throw to Bryant. He's a big, tall guy that can really run. He's fast.
Limping around a little bit as he went to the sidelines. Remember, he missed three games with a shoulder injury earlier this season, but three targets for him, and he's made the most of them so far.
Wildcat.
Isaiah Wright. This is what he's done a lot of this year, and he'll take it to the sideline close to the sticks. Good run on first down for the freshman. Hassan Childs ran him out.
And I don't know how they count pancake blocks. Shark is knocking them all down. He is, and I thought when you said he's one of 11 kids, he had to be tough to get to eat. 11 kids at the table, you got to fight for your food.
Well, I was going to say, he's on the offensive end. This is like being at home. 11 guys on the same side right here.
Yes, and Wright's a really good football player. They're so excited about him for the future. He's big, he's strong, he's smart, he has good instincts. They'll put him in when they get inside the 50 in Wildcat.
Here's Armstead. Going to burst through that hole. A good job to fill it by the South Florida defense. Nigel Harris was one of the guys who stepped right into that hole, and another third down and short coming up here as Sanchez was there with Harris.
The Owls made 3 out of 4 first downs on the first drive. They were all inside of 2 yards, so this is exactly who they want to be. And I think we'll see them go 2 downs here to try to make it. And they're going to go power play one side or the other.
Look at the South Florida defense trying to find the right side. It's Augie Sanchez, who's the quarterback of that defense, trying to direct everybody to the right spot. Here is Armstead, big head of steam, first down into the red zone goes Temple.
As a football coach, when they know you're going to run it, and you know you're going to run it, and you still make yards, that's one of the more exciting times at, in a football game. Backside guard pulls around. You got a down block by the tight end, kick out by Sharga. Really good first down play on 3rd and 2.
They are 6 for 8 on 3rd down in the first quarter plus of this game.
Only thing stopping them are the penalties.
Speaking of which, Mac,
just killing them.
False start. Offense. Number 86. 5-yard penalty. First down.
6 all on the offense. 3 of them have been false starts.
And one thing they may need to do is quit checking so much. Because when you sit in there and you're listening and you get anxious and you've got really good players on the other side of the line of scrimmage, sometimes you move too quickly trying to cut them off. So they may just start going on a quicker snap and not have a check with me.
Jahad Thomas back in the game. He's the tail of that offset eye. He's got Thompson pull blocking for him from the tight end spot on the other side. He'll run into Harris at the 16. Second down and long coming up here for Temple. It's a Temple team that had that massive season a year ago, 10 wins, tying the program record, went to a bowl game for the first time since 2011. They were in the top 20 in the polls for the first time since 1979. Matt Rhule is trying to really coach this team now, he told us. It's easy when you got all the talent in the world, especially on defense. Now he's got to push the right buttons with this group.
National championship team, I said, good job, guys. That's good, Ben.
Yeah, of course, you had all the talent
good
in the
job,
world, right?
Defense, yeah. Had to figure out what time to get them out of the game.
Walker to the end zone and incomplete. Looking for Kirkwood. That 6'3" frame lunging out, could not snare it. He's trying to get past Nichols on the coverage, and it's 3rd and 12.
Really good job by Nichols getting his hands on him and just disrupting the timing of the pass enough that the ball's overthrown. Kirkwood's a big, tall guy at 6'3". See, Nichols gets on him just enough. Not pass interference. He gets his hands on him before the ball's in the air. Disrupts the throw, goes over his head.
So a team that has been really good on 3rd down tonight, but just 33% for the season, finds itself in a 3rd down and long scenario in the red zone. Pressure from the Bulls coming, and past the sticks, it's caught by Bryant. He has been the 3rd down and long target. 1st down and goal for Temple.
And you're running the ball so well, you get one-on-one outside. Johnny Ward had trouble covering him on the post. Turned the post into a square end. Bryant's a very good football player. He's tall. And all of his first down, or all 15 of his catches, or all 5 last week were for a first down.
And he's doing it again tonight. Armstead, good penetration by Hector. Redshirt junior, who's 2nd on the team in sacks, makes a big play to hold off Temple for another snap.
That's the only way they can stop the power running game. These backs are good enough. You've got to get penetration and get it stopped before you get started. A lot of the Temple running game is based on pulling a guard or a tackle.
Right.
And with penetration, it disrupts everything. And this is what Temple hadn't done very well, Adam. They haven't scored touchdowns when they're inside the 10.
Less than 60% touchdown rate this year. Walker moving the pocket. Looking back the other way. Wide open man. Touchdown, Colin Thompson. The first career touchdown for the redshirt senior.
Of What a great call by Glenn Thomas. Sprint to the right. We've been sprinting. We're powered. Delay the tight end. Send him out to the back after the man coverage is all on the other side of the field. Out there by himself. It's a hard catch when you're that wide open because you've got a lot of time for that ball to hang. Very good play call and execution for the Temple touchdown.
And another extended yard-churning drive that lasts over 8 minutes for the Owls. We're able to take a 10-7 lead past the halfway point of the second quarter. Colin Thompson suffered two injury-plagued years with the Florida Gators before he made the transfer. On the 19th catch of his Temple career, the redshirt senior has his first score. Temple on top. You know, we've had a lot of fun on this Friday night tour, and last week we got to go to Louisville, Kentucky and see one of those great dual threat quarterbacks in Lamar Jackson with an explosive offense around him. And Duke did a great job of taking Lamar away because they just kept the football and stayed on the field. We've got a great dual threat quarterback with a lot of weapons in South Florida and Quinton Flowers, and tonight so far Temple keeping him off the field.
34 plays for Temple offensively, 9 plays for South Florida and Quinton Flowers. They've had 2 drives, 7:50 and 8:12, and they've had trouble scoring in the red zone, but not this time. Start running to the right. Look at the eyes of the quarterback. Phillip Walker does such a great job selling it. And then you see 57, the linebacker. Nigel Harris lets his eyes go. Colin Thompson all alone in the end zone by himself after making the block like he's delayed down and slipping out the backside. Very good play. A lot of pressure now on South Florida's offense.
Dearness Johnson steps into the backfield next to Flowers. And on the read, here comes our impact player for South Florida in that running game. And he bangs his way for 10 and a first down into Jaquise Thomas.
It's a speed sweep. A lot of people call it a jet sweep. You get a fast guy on the corner. They're lined up ready to go again.
South Florida's time of possession on the season is only about 26 minutes. They're an explosive offense. Flowers tucks it, runs it, good job. And he gets past the 40-yard line. We'll mark him out at the 41.
It's hard to contain this guy, but Temple's defensive ends are going to have to do a better job of trying to keep Quinton in the pocket or at least make him run up inside. They can't let him get outside that pocket. He's got too many things he can do.
Hands to Johnson, and he gets stuffed shy of the line to gain. Stephon Marshall, redshirt senior, in the thick of things for Temple's defense. And this is a big third down and 2.
You have got to give your defense some rest, too. They've been out there 34 plays. You need to stay on the field offensively.
Screen for Chris Barr, and he's got the first down and more. Inside the Temple 45-yard line. Fourth catch of the season for Chris Barr, the sophomore out of Jacksonville. 13 yards before Artrell Foster caught up to him.
Get the ball in a really good player's hands in space and let him go. I thought it was interesting that he does not check with me at the line of scrimmage. They caught Temple before they got off the field.
No flag thrown as Temple was substituting. Flowers using his feet to keep the play alive. And Quinton Flowers close to the first down. Chappelle Russell was there at the 35, about a half yard shy of the line to gain, but he ran a long way to snare 9 there.
Guy, the toughest job tonight's Phil Snow trying to figure out what defenses to call to slow this young man down. So far, he hadn't gotten the answer.
Fourth-year defensive coordinator for Temple. Here's Rodney Adams, their slot receiver, who's got the first down. No, incomplete pass. We will rule it incomplete, or perhaps the knee was down. I think they're going to say the knee was down because they mark it. Let's see. They're going to mark it right at the initial spot, so it's going to be an incomplete pass. Yep, incomplete pass. If they had marked it back maybe a half yard or a full yard, it would have meant that it was a completion and the knee was down. And Phil Snow's defense trying to get USF off the field.
A great defensive quarter. He was with Bruce Snyder. Out at Arizona State for a long time. Guy knows what he's doing.
A longtime Pac-10 assistant coach. Spent some time at Boise State. Toss play running left. And a big hit past the sticks. But a good job to move the chains. And Delvon Randall was there to bang down Johnson.
Good Real call time. By the offense, Adam. The defense is blitzing up inside. Listen to this hit.
Big pop.
Elvin Randall can bring 208 pounds.
Thrown down the seam, and it is caught. Tyree McKentz immediately back on the field after coming off earlier in this quarter, and he's there for the 31-yard strike.
Got a stack formation, showed the screen. They got in a situation where he was one-on-one with Thomas, Jaquise Thomas. Thomas just didn't have the speed to stay up. Plus, he took a false step, looking like he was going to come up and take the screen.
I got to tell you, Mac, a couple of times on that drive, it looked like Temple was a little slow figuring out subs and looks and protections and things like that. Nadelman on, and that extra point is blocked. It can be returned. It is scooped up. Praise Martin Oquequeh had the block. And a lateral will send it back. Temple still in possession of it. And down it'll go at midfield. Ended up in the hands of Hassan Reddick. But it was Praise Martin Oquequeh who had the block to keep it at a three-point game. Emilio Nadelman, the redshirt junior, just the second time in his career on 97 tries. He's missed an extra point. The block keeps it at three.
Just hungry.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Pizza Hut. No one out pizzas the Hut. And Allstate, proud supporters of college football. It's good to be in good hands.
Cherry on Pep Rally started about 4 years ago, and they have that at the center of campus at the iconic Bell Tower. And this, the brand new tradition started by the Cherry Crusade. Official student organization made up mostly of the diehard fans here at Temple, and they've filled this place out pretty nicely tonight at the link. We said it, sometimes yep. The Eagles have a tendency to bury Temple football. The 76ers are starting up on Wednesday on ESPN. The Flyers have gotten going in the last couple of weeks. And sometimes Temple football goes by the wayside, but right now this is a program that is right at the cusp of doing something historic. Randall Jones upended shy of the 20-yard line by Nico Sautel. And 4:58 to play here in this first half, Temple ball. A lot of people know Greg Ward Jr. He leads the American Conference in total offense. Right behind him is Quinton Flowers, who's already responsible for 22 touchdowns this year.
What a play. Good play call by Willie Taggart. Better execution. They're going to fake it outside to Adams. You're going to have McCants blocking. He's going to show he's blocking on the screen. Jaquise Thomas comes up. He gets his feet off balance over the top for a touchdown. Really good score. South Florida scored fast.
They haven't had the ball for a whole lot in this game. They've got the three-point lead after the blocked extra point. Walker, they've got a convoy out there for Thomas. And he's able to turn it into a positive play. About 4 yards out to the 23, where Deidrin Sinat was there for the stop.
Yeah, Sinat so quick. Guy's big. He's like a bowling ball out there. Hard to block. He's a two-cap guy inside. Read the screen very, very well. Chased it down for the tackle.
JT Barrett certainly has to be on everybody's Heisman list right now with how dominant Ohio State has been. They got tested in Madison last week, and they'll be tested again in a tough environment in State College. 6-5 are the Buckeyes there since 93. But Urban Meyer is 20-0 in true road games. That is unbelievable. On second down, here is Armstead. Got past that first wave and burst through. This will be the longest play of Raquel Armstead's career, and it puts the Owls in front. Seventy-six-yard touchdown.
Had both backs in there. He fakes to Thomas on the speed sweep. He hands it underneath to Armstead, and he just outruns them. Really good misdirection. South Florida's defense lost their eye discipline, and he just squirts it down the sideline. People talk about him being a power runner. He showed a lot of speed on that play.
He's the yak back, yards after first contact.
Well, there wasn't any contact that time.
A whole lot there. Yeah, he got through that first wave.
He's going fast.
He showed the burst ability. His longest career run was 37 yards. That was against SMU. That one was the longest of his career and the longest play from scrimmage for the Temple offense on the season. Listen, we've been pumping up South Florida's offense as explosive. Temple showing a little bit of that ability right now, too. And a back-and-forth first half in Philly has the Owls in front. Raquel Armstead's over 100 yards for the second time in his career after that 76-yard touchdown run. And watch the middle of the South Florida defense. They get caught up with the Thomas motion.
Yeah, Sanchez loses his eyes a little bit. He just shuffles his feet. And the offensive line does a good job. Armstead breaks the tackle, outruns Goodwin for the touchdown. Godwin cannot run him down, shows you the speed for a big guy. 205 pounds, just the little speed sweep, jet sweep look helped Sanchez up inside enough that he couldn't get to scrape and tackle Armstead up inside.
Longest play allowed by the South Florida Bull Shark defense this season. So Rodney Adams with a chance from the 1 yard line. Already got a return for a touchdown in his career. And the kicker, Boomery, slows him up. And finally, the rest of that Temple coverage unit catches up to him near midfield. So good field position as we check in for the first time with Adnan Virk. What's up, man?
Not too much, Adam. I want to let you know what's happening on the Alexis Halftime Report as a huge game between Texas A&M and Alabama. Joey Galloway will tell you what A&M has to do to pull off the victory. Also, turnaround teams, why South Florida is one of those teams this year, even though they're trailing Temple right now. And Oregon and Cal, what is up with the Ducks? Danny Cannell will explain what's happening right now with Oregon. All that more coming up at the half. Adam, back to you.
Adnan, thanks very much. Danny Thomas, as came back here to Philly, was getting tagged with a taunting penalty. And throughout all of this, during that Rodney Adams return, there is a Temple player down on the field. We have not been able to identify him just yet. 3:50 to play here in this first half. And a great return by Adams. Will get called back a little bit due to that taunting penalty after the play. The ball was spotted right near midfield at the end of the return. Believe, don't want to say for certain, but we believe that's Jeremiah Atoki, redshirt freshman out of Vineland, New Jersey. So we're going to step aside as the Temple staff tends to him here with 3:50 to go in the first half. We return to the link in Philadelphia, and we believe Jeremiah Atoki, a freshman, in that big return from Rodney Adams, took the worst of the damage. That indeed is the freshman, Atoki. Molly McGrath, you were down on the sidelines. What did you see?
Yeah, that's right. There was a lot of panic here on the Temple sideline. As you saw, he got up on his own power, but they were calling for an ambulance. I'll keep you guys updated as this progresses.
Thanks very much, Molly. So it was a great return by Adams. The Danny Thomas taunting penalty will bring it back to the 34-yard line. And while you're watching this replay, lock your eyes to about the 20-yard line. You see 19, the second from the right for Temple, is coming downfield. And it looks like he went head-on with South Florida's Cecil Cherry. So South Florida starts this drive from the 34, and Marlon Mack gets buried back behind the line of scrimmage. Good penetration by the Temple defense. And it was praise Martin Ogwike, who has the point after block in this game as well. It ends up being a loss of 5.
He had such great field position. Foolish penalty like we've talked about with Temple. Coach Taggart's going to be furious that they lose 15 yards for the personal foul, and now they're in second down 15 because of the penetration early on that play. Lost a lot of field position.
Yeah, South Florida moving backwards in these last couple of plays. The fake on the sweep and nothing there. Guess who? Praise Martin Ogwike. The redshirt senior is there again to help lead that Temple charge. Back-to-back tackles for loss for a guy who's got over 15 in his career.
Yeah, this guy's such a good football player. He's quick. You see him look outside, shuffles his feet. He keeps the containment, and he makes Flowers turn up inside like we talked about earlier.
Exactly. You pointed that out right away. You have to contain the quarterback who can get outside the pocket. Third down and 16. To the sideline, and McCants again is there, and he made the catch right at midfield. His second big play of the day.
They're in a two deep coverage, which is a safe coverage on third down and long. Perfect throw by Flowers to McCants. He got it over the corner's head for the first down.
Picked up 22 on third and 16, and now Flowers sees space on the far side. A great job to shed the block by Nate Hairston, the cornerback. There is a penalty marker on the play, though.
I think Nate's mad because they just threw it over his head, Adam. I think that's what he's doing.
Holding offense, number 85. 10-yard penalty, first down.
As we told you, Jeremiah Atoki on that return from Rodney Adams got the worst of the hit from Cherry, and he is being helped back towards the locker rooms here at the home of the Philadelphia Eagles, an NFL stadium with very good facilities. Back to the 40-yard line after that penalty to set up first down and 20. The South Florida, a couple of markers on this drive. Have them right back in their own territory as we approach two to play in the first half. It will be South Florida ball to start half number two. Flowers. Penetration again from Temple, and from the ankles down he goes. This time it's Avery Robinson. The ball was whistled down at the 32-yard line.
And once again, Adam, both ends did a tremendous job of getting upfield. Look at Riddick here. Gets upfield, forces him back inside. When he's inside, he's got a lot fewer options than when he gets outside, and he's got his run pass options. And it just kills that secondary when they come up.
And again, the contain is there.
It's there.
You don't have to necessarily rush, but you got to stay in front of them.
Very good adjustment by Coach Snow and his defensive staff on that bench.
So now second down and more than a quarter of the field. Flowers contained again. Launches it off his back foot into the Temple bench. Will there be a talk about intentional grounding here? He might have still been in the tackle box, but there was a receiver in the area. Did he make it past the line of scrimmage on that throw? Is the other
quarterback was outside the pocket. Incomplete pass, third down.
So he was ruled outside the pocket. That's the key. So no grounding penalty. And I think Matt Rhule wanted the grounding penalty, but it's still third down and 27 here.
Well, another great job by Jacob Martin, number 9, the defensive end. Flowers started to fake inside, get outside. But Martin turned him up inside, and then he had to throw it to get rid of it. Really good series by the defense. They can't give up another third and long here. Let's see what Coach Snow does.
First charge, timeout.
Coach Taggart knows South this Florida. Is an important play. You're going to bring him over and talk about it.
Again, it will be South Florida ball to start the second half, so perhaps they may played a little bit conservatively here in the final minute. Temple still does have two timeouts with which to work. So in the SEC West, outside of Bama and Texas A&M, it's a log jam, and we've got four teams all in the top 25 that are in the hunt. Arkansas and Auburn will square off. First true SEC road game for Arkansas. And then I guess some people are tagging this the Ed Orgeron Bowl with Ole Miss and LSU. So what are you expecting tomorrow night in Baton Rouge, a place that's been very difficult for Ole Miss to win?
Well, it's going to be fun. I coach there. I go back to the Billy Cannon run and October 31st, 1959.
That's
probably right.
Yep.
Right before you were born.
Yeah,
Adam.
Of course. Yeah.
But this has been around Halloween. It's one of the more fun games in the country. Ed Orgeron's interviewing for that job every day of the week. So it'll be a fun game to watch.
Brent Musburger, Jesse Palmer, Kaylee Hartung on the call from Baton Rouge tomorrow night. Third down at 27 here for South Florida, and they will go through the air. Flowers throwing right to the sticks. It looked like it was short, even though Adams made the grab, but it will be ruled incomplete anyway. Had he made it inbounds, it still would have been fourth down and short. And inside of a minute to go, South Florida will punt it away.
Well, it was a good throw, just a little bit late, because Adams is wide open and he didn't catch the ball inbounds. But again, they would be short of the sticks. Probably would have gone for it with 56 seconds left to go in the half. But they're just going to go in, be smart now. Temple will go in at them, be smart. Take their lead because South Florida gets the ball to start the second half.
Well, 47 and down to 46 seconds to play on a 37-yard punt. Temple will have the ball. They do have two timeouts. They've got the ball at their own 30-yard line. They do have a freshman kicker in there if they're thinking about trying to get into field goal range.
Well, they did score in 31 seconds.
That's true.
Last week to beat Central Florida. So.
Yeah, and the ball was right here at the 30-yard line last week with 30 seconds to go.
They've got this game plan. I still think we see a screen or a draw most likely, and he takes this lead into halftime. This first half has been just what Matt Rhule wanted.
So Thomas is in the game. It is a read play. There's nothing there on first down. Mike Love is there for the stop. And that first down play might dictate the rest of these seconds for Temple. The play clock is about a second shy of the game clock here.
You could take a deep shot the last play of the half.
South Florida rushes four. Over the middle, it is caught by Roman Deloach, and he's got the first down. This makes things a little bit more interesting as he takes it to the 46.
Now you go fast. You got two timeouts. You use one of the timeouts to save your clock. Now you can actually have a chance to get points.
Now we've told you.
30-second timeout.
They've got the freshman kicker. They lost Austin Jones to that torn ACL on that 95-yard kickoff return touchdown against Memphis a couple of Thursdays ago. But Boumery has already made one from 22 tonight. And he made a 47-yarder last week against UCF. That's a pretty good kick. That's the longest field goal made by a Temple Owl since Brandon McManus, the Super Bowl winner in 2012. So they've got a little bit of cushion to work with. You get down to maybe the 30-yard line in South Florida territory here.
And it's amazing what doing it last week and winning a game, the amount of confidence that gives you as an offense and a coaching staff, because they've already done it. They know what this feels like. So I think we see a couple of good passes now and trying to get into field goal range.
So there is the freshman from Phillipsburg, Pennsylvania.
I think if you're a freshman, you want to be named Boom Boom, right?
It's not a bad name for a kicker, right?
No.
Still a timeout in 16 seconds. Four-man South Florida rush. Walker taking a deep shot. And it is Ventel Bryant. It is incomplete. It is ruled incomplete inside the 20. Matt Rhule is maybe hoping that they might take a look at this play again with 8 seconds to go.
Well, it was a double move. He started outside and came back. Oh, that's close.
Very close.
That is close. Is the foot down right there?
I think the right foot.
Right heel was down.
But again, there's three components
Ruling
to look
on
at.
The field of an incomplete pass is under further review.
So John Smith is our replay official in this American Conference crew. So you got to look for a couple of things. Do you have the catch? Do you have the ball in two hands or up against your body? Do you have something that's traditionally thought of as a catch? Do you get 1 foot inbounds with the possession of that ball? And do you complete that process? Do you survive the hit to the ground with control?
I say yes, yes, and yes.
Okay.
Looks like it to me. Heels down, right there. He's got control of the ball. He takes it to the ground.
I think he survived that hit to the ground. I've been told by Bill Lemonnier and Dave Kataya, our fantastic rules experts at ESPN, those are the things that officials are looking for. Do you have those three things locked up? The catch, the foot, and the possession all the way through. And if you say yes to all three of those, you got to rule it a catch. But remember, the call on the field is an incompletion. So if there's not indisputable video evidence to overturn that call, you have to stick with the call on the field.
And it was a subtle thing, but I'm sure that Ventel Bryant said something to the official that probably wasn't the most gracious thing to say. Coach Rhule made him go back over and shake his hand and apologize.
Interesting. Now, that's a 36-yard play if they do rule that as a catch, so it sets them up at the 18. They're clearly in field goal range. You have one timeout with 8 seconds left. You might be able to do something towards the end zone, or you can try to kick a field goal and take a 7-point lead into halftime.
Well, and while these guys are looking at the play upstairs, they're going through all that as an offensive staff right now. Do we have Hail Mary? Do we have an out that's a 6-yard out that we can get in field goal range? What are our options here if they give it to us and if they don't? They're discussing all of that at this time.
And remember, it was Bryant last week that had three catches, to get them to the 8-yard line, which set up the game-winning touchdown. That 70-yard drive, 62 of those yards were Ventel Bryant's yards last week.
Bryant made the catch. He cut his face, and Adonis Jennings pulled him up and got him set so they could throw the last play of the game. The other thing that was interesting is Philip Walker last week did not spike the ball with 10 seconds left. He went ahead and threw the ball in the end zone for the touchdown, which is very unusual.
Yeah, they did not go for the spike.
Would spike the ball and talk about it. They didn't talk about it. They're playing at a high level of confidence with the Temple offense.
After further review, the receiver completed the catch, inbounds. The ball will be placed at the 18-yard line, first and 10. The clock will start on the snap.
So Temple does have a timeout here. The clock will start at the snap because he had the ball and then went out of bounds inside of 2 minutes for the half. So the clock will not start until the ball is snapped. They'll spot it, as he said, at the 18-yard line. Still 8 seconds to go. They're well within field goal range already. And the field goal kicker, Aaron Boumery, is out there. Tom Bradway is his holder. So this would be about a 35 or 36-yarder to end the half and take a 7-point lead into halftime.
He didn't want to take a chance on the 8 seconds. That's about the limit. And he trusts Boom Boom. Trust his freshman to kick it through.
In for the injured Austin Jones, trying to make it 4 for 4 on field goals to start his career. The kick is on the way, and Boom Boom booms it right through to give Temple a 7-point lead at the 5-second mark of the second quarter. Bryant had the big catch on the drive to set up the field goal.
This is a lot of momentum for Temple.
Absolutely it is.
Coaches being aggressive. What a catch by Bryant on the boundary. They're going to take a lot of momentum into the halftime, and South Florida is going to have to come out and try to take this momentum back in the first 5 minutes of the second half.
Now again, Temple's 4-3, but they're 2-1 in the conference in this division in the Eastern. 3-0 is South Florida. They're trying to get to 7-1 overall. Remember, their only loss is to Florida State, a top 25 team. But the reason this game is important, Navy, tomorrow, Memphis, that's a game that's big for Navy that's in the top 25. They've already got that tiebreaker over Houston, a team that people expected to run the table in the conference. South Florida, Temple, these are teams that are in the hunt. UCF sitting at 1-1. Important games as we get closer to November and we start thinking about the second American Conference championship game.
Well, and the other thing, Adam, to be the best of the group of five, you've got to win your conference championship.
That's right. And that's something South Florida's
very important.
High bounce on the squib kick, grabbed by the up man, Dearness Johnson. And Dearness Johnson trying to break free. Just the kicker to beat. Boumery finally slowed him up, and he was caught up to the 30 by Linwood Crump. And a little bit of a scare into the Owls, put into them by Dearness Johnson at the end of the half.
I think that's just a message. Hey, Temple, we're not going away. We're not through. And Johnson is their impact player. Coach said he was the best player on their football team because every time he touches it, he has a chance to score.
South Florida has the ball to start half number two, but the Bulls at 6-1 are trailing. Temple's got the halftime lead. Our Lexus halftime report is right now. Adnan Enverk, take it away, my man.
This halftime report is presented by Lexus.
Now the Owls in full effect, but South Florida making some noise as well, including Marquez Valdez-Scantling. 27-yard touchdown catch. Currently South Florida down by 7. Their head coach Willie Taggart talking to Molly McGrath.
Coach, Temple had that explosive play. They're sustaining long drives. What do you need to do defensively?
We got to get off the field. We got to do a better job on first down and to get them in a longer situation. And then we got to do a better job getting off the field on third down. They getting first down and holding the ball, and we got to do a better job defensively.
Yeah, speaking of third downs, they held you to third and long. What do you need to see specifically from Quentin Flowers in the second half?
Well, just let Quentin be Quentin. We got to stop putting ourselves in bad situations with the penalties. We got too many selfish penalties that's putting us behind the chain, and that's not good.
All right, thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Diamond heart.
Lady Gaga's new album, Joanne, dropped from Interscope Records in store today. As we welcome you back to Philadelphia, look at the Ben Franklin Bridge, and you're watching the American Conference on ESPN, a crucial American Conference East Division game. Undefeated South Florida, 6-1 overall, tested by the Temple Owls in their hometown, a 20-13 Owls lead at the halftime break. Welcome you back into the broadcast booth. Adam Amin, Mac Brown, Molly McGrath will join us in a moment as well. So Quinton Flowers, we discussed how explosive he is. He's up there with some of the best dual threat quarterbacks in the country. But Temple has done the right things. They've run the ball to keep him off the field, and then they've contained him a little bit.
Well, and they've got to continue to do that, Adam, to win this football game. In the first half, they had great ball control like they do. You start looking at Sarga coming out of the backfield and blocking. Raquel Armstead sterned up inside, but this time he hits the home run and takes it the distance for the touchdown. But what they're doing so well on defense, after early in the ball game where they were not containing Quinton Flowers very well, now you're looking at Hassan Riddick 7 and Jacob Martin number 9, keeping him in the pocket, forcing him back up inside for the sack. Now don't let him outside. You got him inside, you got him outside, forces him to throw the ball away. And that is keeping South Florida from the easy scores that they had early in the game.
De'Ernest Johnson had a 47-yard return on a squib kick to close the half, and they'll go back to the squib kick here, keep it short, and it's grabbed by one of the upmen for South Florida, Juwan Brown. There is a penalty marker on the play. A busy first half for Todd LaPenta and this American Conference crew. Todd, a mortgage banker on the side, or maybe a referee on the side, not sure.
During the return, holding, receiving team, number 36, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Moments ago, Molly McGrath was with Matt Rhule, the Temple head coach.
Coach, you're up 7 despite 6 offensive penalties. How have you battled through that?
Well, I think we've run the ball extremely well. We're 7-for-9 on third down, haven't turned the ball over. Some of the plays where we hurt ourselves with penalties, we fought back. But if we could ever just not beat ourselves, we might be a heck of a football team.
The Bulls getting the ball back. What do you want to see from your defense?
Well, I mean, how amazing is their quarterback? My goodness. I'd like to start by tackling their kickoff returner and just keep playing. I mean, they're a great team. We're playing really well. It's a fun night, so just keep playing till the end of the game.
All right. Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Molly, he made a really good point to you about those penalties. They did do a good job of battling through some of those to at least move the chains and stay on the field, but third and long, that's when we see that great contain from Temple's defense.
Well, and he has stopped the penalties for Temple the last couple of drives, and they've moved over to South Florida. But their power football the second half, controlling the clock, and the ability to contain the quarterback is going to be the difference in this ball game for Temple.
Dominique Threat, the senior out of Atlanta, their normal right guard, just went off the field. Brooks Larkin is a redshirt freshman now at right guard. They go away from that side of the line and go to Marlon Mack on the perimeter, and he's across the 30-yard line. Stopped out there by Jared Folks, the middle linebacker in this 4-3 Temple defense.
Marlon Mack is so versatile, Adam. You can run him up inside. He's got tremendous hands. He can pass block. He'll be a great player at the next level.
Man, they've got him running all over the field, putting him to the near side in that quad set, and away from it goes Quinton Flowers. We've seen this a few times tonight. We've seen this a lot this season. Spread everybody out, let the man do the work.
Well, very good play selection. He had all the receivers to the field. He looked like he was going to throw the screen, had the counter, quarterback counter back into the boundary for a big first down.
19 yards on that play.
He just makes it look so easy.
Yep.
That's what the great ones do.
Michael Dogby lost his helmet, so he has to come off the field for one snap. He's part of that front four.
Remember, when they look to the boundary, they are not checked with me. That's Willie Taggart telling him what play to change to.
Now, Willie calls all the offense from the sideline. Dominique Threat is back in at right guard, and he helps block for Marlon Mack. And Mack is able to dive ahead for a few, undercut by Avery Robinson. Next 3 weekends of football in this conference are huge. Divisional championship implications, maybe New Year's 6 implications. And tonight, the top 2 teams in the East squaring off in Philly. On second down, late pitch, Marlon Mack still stretching it to the sideline, and not a whole lot of room to make something happen. Hairston, the cornerback, helped out with Artrell Foster to force out Mack.
They lost contain on the corner, but he did make it bounce outside. And it was really good pursuit inside out by that defense. And Delvin Randall making the play on the boundary.
He forced him outside. They fake it to Adams. It's Flowers on the move and a great Foster tackle in open field to stop him at the 41-yard line.
And I do think we'll see Willie Taggart go for the fourth down here, and he's going to call something fast.
They have gone 10 of 11 on fourth down this season. And they give it to Marlon Mack, and he's got the first down. Needed the 39 and just got past it. Jared Folks was there for the stop, but not before Mack got the necessary yardage.
And number one, Willie Taggart had no choice. You don't want to give the ball back to Temple right now. The way they're controlling the clock, and you've got a tired defense, so you had to go for it. He went to his best back, Marlon Mack, up inside for the play.
You know, we've been talking about group of five teams. Western Michigan, one of those great group of five teams. They're the only team that has a better percentage. They're 100% on fourth down this year. South Florida is now 11 of 12.
And P.J. Fleck has also beaten two Big Ten teams.
Illinois,
beat Northwestern and Illinois.
Absolutely. They will measure this. Based on the spot, it looked like it should have been enough. And indeed, it is.
Seems like it takes forever for that thing to stretch. And if you're Coach Taggart, you're saying, pull it! Stretch it hard!
Those are the teams we're talking about in this ranked group of five set. South Florida, with a win tonight, you could certainly believe that they have a case at 7-1 to be in the top 25. And they face Navy next week on our air in Tampa.
Empty backfield. You're going to have quarterback run or you're going to have quick screen, most likely.
Well, Temple's bringing heat against Flowers, so it's a numbers game. He throws it to the outside, and DeErnest Johnson gets grabbed by Nate L. Smith near the 35-yard line. So basically, Flowers is looking in the box and counting.
Yeah, he's got him spread out so he can run the ball, and if the numbers aren't right, the blitz made the numbers where he wanted to throw the ball outside, but good job by Temple.
So again, the blitz comes, and now he's got nowhere to go. So they kept that same formation and alignment against the same five receiver look. And that time Flowers had nowhere to go.
Brought five people up inside, had a little game with the lineman where they crossed, confused the offensive lineman for South Florida. And now we're talking about a big third down and 10.
Let's see how Quentin Flowers reacts. Molly told us about the maturity, the growth of Quentin Flowers. You never see him sweat, said Willie Taggart his quarterback.
Yeah, looks like they're coming after the no backs.
And he's got an open man in the middle of the defense. It's Mitchell Wilcox, the red shirt freshman, for the first down to the 25-yard line. There's an injured bull back near midfield.
Boy, good job standing in the pocket. The same blitz. They brought six guys after him. They had very good gap control. He just sat back in there, stood tall, and hit his tight end down the middle.
So there is Kofi Amichia, 23rd career start tonight for the redshirt senior, and he's being tended to and will step aside during this South Florida drive. His parents born in Ghana, grew up in Riverdale, Georgia. Redshirt senior Kofi Amichia, the left tackle, very important position. With a guy like Quentin Flowers, a quarterback, he's having his right leg tended to. Marcus Norman, the redshirt freshman, slides to left tackle, and Eric Mays, the sophomore, is the new right tackle. As South Florida has first down and 10 at the 25 of Temple, trailing by 7 early in the third.
Got unbalanced to the field. You've got your quarterback runs backside, or all of your passes front side.
And that's Marlon Mack taking the carry between the tackles for a couple. What do you like from South Florida's offense? What have you liked from these formations, these alignments, this Temple? What do you like so far?
I like the fact that they've got you so spread out, a lot like the Baylor stuff we saw early in the year. And then you just count numbers, and they've got good enough players to get it to the receivers to make yards or up inside. Willie's just calling them off the sideline.
End around, Rodney Adams. He's done this a lot in his career, but that is snuffed out. Hassan Reddick was stretching that play all the way to the sideline, along with Stephon Marshall, two single-digit number tough Temple guys, for a loss of two.
Yeah, we talked about Hassan Reddick as an impact player early in the ball game. This guy is so good. He's so fast. He's one of the best pass rushers in the country.
So now another third and long. South Florida, on their 9 third down attempts, has averaged 9 yards to go. And Temple goes 3 down linemen. They're rushing just three with a spy. Flowers trying to break contain. Wants it all to the end zone, and it's out of bounds. Probably the right decision for Flowers, and an excellent coverage play on defense by Temple.
They lost contain, but they still did a good enough job of forcing him deep and forcing him back to the outside. So if you're the defensive end, upfield, upfield, upfield. They had a spy, they had a three-man rush. They lose the contain, but the linebacker is in his face enough, he can't turn up and makes him throw it out of bounds.
So Flowers, you can imagine he's frustrated, but as we said, he doesn't change his body language very often, but he does look a little frustrated right now. So Emilio Nadelman from 42. And Nadelman, with good distance on it, is able to bang it through inside the left upright. He is now 7 of his last 8 from over 40 yards. He has been rock solid this season at 6 of 6. The redshirt junior out of Miami gets points for South Florida, and the top team in the East now trails by 4.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Chick-fil-A. We didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich. And Voya Financial, changing the way you think of retirement.
Last night, the South Florida Bulls here in Philadelphia, they go out as a team. They go watch the Magnificent Seven. Denzel Washington, Ethan Hawke, Chris Pratt. Not the Magnificent Seven you remember from 1960 with McQueen and Eli Wallen.
Yeah, I was even young for that bunch, and I thought it was great. But good for Willie. That maybe, I doubt if he mentioned it to him because he wasn't alive at that time either.
Well, Willie's only 40 in his fourth season at South Florida. 3 years at his alma mater, Western Kentucky. Played for the great Jack Harbaugh. Has coached under Jim Harbaugh at Stanford as well. And his team trails by 4 as Randall Jones, freshman, tries to patiently find an alley and does so to get past the 20-yard line. That's a decent return. And that'll set up Temple with a 4-point lead. Philip Walker, 5'11", 205-pound senior out of Elizabeth, New Jersey, the all-time leading passer and winner as a starting quarterback now in Temple history. He talked about his toughness. Remember, this guy wore number 11. Everybody knows him as P.J. Walker. And he ends up getting Tyler Matakevich's number. As you see the rain beginning to fall here in Philly. Walker gets the number 8. He gets that single-digit number. He says, call me Philip. I've graduated past P.J. I've matured into Philip. And now the veteran will go to the air and throw behind Bryant, who's been a good target for him tonight. Incomplete second down, but overall Walker's been very good tonight.
He really has. He's taken care of the ball. He's been smart. He's run their offense well. That was a tough throw. It was a little bit behind Bryant, but also for our fans, it's a little bit of a rain now. So the ball may be a little slicker. And I know if you're coming from Tampa, Florida, you haven't seen rain. So it's one of those you're saying, oh no, now it's raining. Come on, man.
Second down and 10 for Temple. Quick screen, wide, four rights, and nothing much there. Right back at the line of scrimmage. Good play on defense by Nate Godwin. Molly, you're down on the field. Rain going to affect these offenses in the near future right now?
Well, Adam, it started out as a really light rain. It's picking up. And one thing for South Florida, it's getting a little chilly down here. It was warm to start out the game, but it's getting a lot colder as the rain is now starting, guys.
Yeah. Remember, this is a team that's coming from South Florida. Believe it or not, and this is the first cool weather. There's been a heat wave here in Philadelphia and a lot of the country, but we're dealing with some cool weather for the first time. Walker pumping, Walker throwing, and a great play by Kirkwood near midfield. And he has gotten loose too many times for Raymond Woody and South Florida's defense liking tonight.
Well, a lot of credit to the offensive line too. They picked up the blitz. South Florida brought a bunch of them. It's man free, so it's man coverage, double move. But we just talked about Philip Tucker, and he threw the ball perfectly outside, even though Sadat hit the quarterback well. But watch him jump up. These guys are feeling good about their game tonight. A lot of confidence.
Direct snap to Wright. He's got the read play, and he keeps it. And Isaiah Wright, a quick-footed freshman, will spin to the 50 for 4 yards.
Well, we always felt like, Adam, the first 5 minutes of the second half is so critical. South Florida did a good job taking the lead from Temple's offense and slowing it down with a 5-minute drive. And it was 14 plays and 50 yards. Now their defense has to make a stop. You've got to answer if you're Temple. And that clock just keeps running and ticking and ticking. And that's what Temple wants.
They use right again off the sweep. Sanchez is there for the stop at the 47.
He kind of slipped at that time. Now, when the grass gets, this is a pro stadium, it's real grass. When it gets a little bit wet, you've got to plant your foot and get all your cleats in the ground and turn up north and south. You cannot turn on the side of your foot because you are going to slip, exactly like Isaiah Wright did that time. Plant, go north and south.
You see some of the divots that are starting to pop up as well. And the South Florida defense coming all the way up from Tampa, trying to stay with this Temple offense, which is grinding out drives. Walker under pressure from Harris, spins away. Will not get away from that second wave. Sinat was one man there. The other was Tajay Fullwood, the safety.
Much more aggressive now with the defensive staff from South Florida. Nigel Harris comes off the corner. He makes the pressure. He makes Tucker turn back up, and it's enough pursuit that the other guys can get back there and make the play. Fullwood and Sinat were back there making the play. You got to be careful when you're punting it to Johnson, because he's also had a touchdown return this year against Syracuse.
It was for 83 yards. Starzik has only put 29% of his punts for his career inside the 20. And they're going to keep it on the ground. A little squib action here to prevent a return. And down to the 16-yard line. A net punt of 38. And that'll take us to a timeout here in the city of brotherly love. Peach Bowl and the Fiesta Bowl are the semifinal games as Ohio State making the push. They've got to go on the road. Tough test. Saturday Night Football on ABC, ESPN app, and watch ESPN. Chris Kirk and Sam will have the call, and they are one of your four college football playoff teams with the first rankings 11 days away.
Adam, I always look at who I think will be there in the end, and it's going to be either Ohio State or Michigan, I think. Both of them might be in the top four, but you got to give Chris Peterson credit. They're quietly making some noise out there at Washington.
South Florida drive with Quinton Flowers breaking it open. The big play for Quinton Flowers on the ground, and he makes it happen, pulled the ball, and took it inside the 40-yard line of Temple.
This is how they can beat you in so many ways. He's got the zone read. He fakes the sweep off the zone read, turns it up, and they're really lucky that Delvon Randall made the tackle.
Marlon Mack now sweeping it to the left, and he's got another first down. Inside the 20-yard line, there's a Temple player down on defense. Two big plays, a 50-yard run, and then Marlon Mack takes it for 16. That is Avery Williams. He's been dealing with an ankle injury this week as well. Another single-digit number guy. Third on the team in tackles. They say he's got the highest threshold for pain on this team, which says a lot.
Well, and Adam, they slowed down their tempo a little bit. Those last two plays were really fast. So they've picked it up and gotten their momentum back.
He's back up on his feet. Well, two big plays, Molly, down on the field for South Florida on this drive. The rain is coming down, but they've got one of their studs up front back on the field as well.
That's right. Left tackle Kofi Amichia had his right knee taped heavily. He was walking gingerly, but training staff said they're going to let him go back out there, try it out, but they will watch him closely, Adam.
So Williams goes to the Temple bench. And Amichia gingerly coming on the field initially, loosening up a little bit as he takes his spot at left tackle. That loaded backfield here. This is a pass play. De'Ernest Johnson's done this before, and a flag is thrown in the end zone looking for Adams. De'Ernest Johnson has thrown two touchdown passes in his career. They set it up for him there, and a penalty marker in the end zone.
Pass interference. defense, number 15, automatic first down.
Veteran Nate Hairston was wrestling with Rodney Adams, and it'll be first down.
Really good sequence of plays. You come out running, and now you come with a speed sweep. Johnson pulls it up, 7 for 8, throws it in the end zone to Adams, and good for Temple. It's either a touchdown or you have the interference call.
A little set up first down and goal. 13 penalties combined between these two teams. Both in the bottom half of the American Conference. Zone read, Flowers walks into the end zone, touchdown Bulls, and South Florida's back on top. Rushing touchdown number 20 in the career of Quinton Flowers.
And look, you've got Marlon Mack and Ernest Johnson in the backfield. All the linebackers flow with them. Easy turn up off of the zone read for Flowers.
And again, this is the explosiveness of the offense that we keep harping on. This is why Matt Rhule wants to keep his offense on the field, because quick strikes are not uncommon for the Bulls, who score in less than a minute here. Nadelman makes the extra point, and South Florida on the fifth lead change in 2.5 quarters is back on top by 3. ...60% of the runs for Quinton Flowers are called runs. About 60 to 70% is what the offensive staff told us, but the rest of them, that's his improvisation. So it's such a dangerous mix when you're playing defense against Quinton Flowers, an excellent dual threat quarterback. A rushing touchdown, the 20th of his career, has put South Florida back in front by 3.
It's kind of pick your poison with these guys too. You got Johnson, you got Mack, you got Adams, you got Quinton, and then when you start getting bothered with all the other guys, they had a lot of them on the field at the same time. He can take it the distance and score quickly.
Johnny Ward has to put the finger on the ball so that Nadelman can kick away. And this will be Randall Jones on the near side of the field. That's a good kick by Nadelman to pin Jones to the sideline, and he takes it out to the 22-yard line. South Florida, the Temple staff told us when they were watching and evaluating tape, they mentioned how good South Florida has been in the second half of games, and so far in this game, 10-0. And over the course of the season, South Florida's offense has done very well in the second half.
Yeah, this is a critical drive for Temple. They've got to go back and answer and make sure that they slow this game back down and get their momentum back, because after the half, South Florida's completely taken the momentum out of Temple, and now they're in charge of this football game. They were really aggressive on defense last drive. Let's see if they keep coming.
Walker will toss to his high school teammate in Thomas, who sweeps to the edge with blockers in front. And Jahad Thomas out across the 30. Nate Godwin on the stop on a 12-yard run. Both out of Elizabeth High School in New Jersey.
Good play call. This is just their simple toss sweep, but they added the fake reverse to get the linebackers and safeties from South Florida to lose their eye discipline and hit back the other way, and it worked perfectly.
Yeah, Adam, you mentioned it. Jahad Thomas admits he may not be at Temple if it weren't for his lifelong friend with Philip Walker. They became close around 7 years old. They played AAU basketball together, played in high school together. And in recruiting Walker, Temple coaches got a chance to see Thomas play.
And he's one of those weapons. This one is Isaiah Wright out of Connecticut. And he goes for 24 yards, the longest run of his freshman year.
And at a time where South Florida's got to step up on defense, still a lot of hands on their hips, and Temple's doing exactly what they need to do, being aggressive, taking it right back to South Florida.
Armstead checks in as part of that power set. We've seen Armstead in the eye a lot more than Thomas. And we see Nick Sharga, the fullback, who's been a stud in the blocking game so far tonight. He's the lead blocker, and he takes out Johnny Ward. Big block, Sharga. Big run, Armstead. Temple takes the lead. A penalty marker was thrown in the end zone. Perhaps there was some excessive celebration. We will check that flag. That will make Matt Rhule upset, but Armstead took it the distance with a big Sharga block on the corner.
Folks, watch number four come on the corner, and I am telling you, he knocks Johnny Ward on his back to let Armstead walk in that end zone. What a critical player and leader on this football team.
I think this is going to be excessive celebration for the Ryan Howard-esque swing at the end of that play. Citizens Bank Park is just on the other side here in the South Philly Sports Complex.
Well, and you can't have it because you've just scored. You take the lead, and now you give them an opportunity to get great field position on the kickoff. Just score, hand it to the official, and act like you've been there before.
After the score, unsportsmanlike conduct, offense, number 25, taunting. This 15-yard penalty will be enforced on the kickoff. This is the first unsportsmanlike conduct foul for number 25 in the ballgame.
Got a little overzealous there, certainly.
And well, he's excited. He's going to score enough. He didn't have to do that.
Yep.
I saw Ricky Williams and Jamal Charles and a bunch of guys at Texas, Cedric Benson, hand the ball to the official many times.
And again, those are the things that Matt Rhule is talking about. Just the little things that he wants to clean up. But two touchdowns to tie the career high for Raquel Armstead. And Boomeri is there for the extra point. And on the sixth lead change of the night, Temple has a four-point advantage. You know, I know we talk about Pac-12 after dark getting weird. We're getting a little weird right here. Good game tonight. Then we'll take out West. We've got Oregon and Cal with Alan Beswick, Mike Pilotti, Chris Button, and then SportsCenter at night with my guys Jonathan Coachman and Max Bredos on ESPN. Off night for the National League Championship Series, but they'll preview what's going on a big sports Saturday with baseball and college football. NBA preseason is starting to wrap up. We're going to tip things off on Wednesday for the NBA season on ESPN. A lot going on tonight when we're done here from Philly and then out in Berkeley.
All right, so much fun tomorrow. And what about BYU at Boise State
last
night?
What a game last night.
Unbelievable. Brian Harsin is just, he's continuing to find ways to win for his football team. And we keep talking about that group of five.
Well, again, three wins by 7 points or less already this year. I mean, it is getting so tight with these teams. And this is the time of year where that happens. Boise State making noise. PJ Fleck and an undefeated Western Michigan team. South Florida Bulls making noise. Navy and Kenny Amatalolo doing another fantastic job in Annapolis with that upset win over division rival Houston.
And next Friday night, we go to Tampa for South Florida hosting Navy. Coming in there, got another great ball game like this one.
Could be a top 25 game next week. So they go short again this time, and it's De'Ernest Johnson from inside the 15 trying to find space. And he will get tackled shy of the 30-yard line. Decent field position here for South Florida. We talked about it last night. What a shocking end to that game. I mean, Kalani Sitake's got to be thinking, what do I got to do to get a blowout? Every game these guys play is close. Rhett Allman has the kick block on second down, but because it didn't pass the line of scrimmage, BYU recovers. They have two more shots. The Taysom Hill Hail Mary, I know this stopped your heart a couple times.
It did. Well, and last year, Brigham Young beat
Boise State.
Hail Mary.
Yeah, exactly. That was Tanner Mangum last year. And this year, Taysom Hill trying to make it happen. Boy, every loss has been heart-wrenching for BYU this year. And Boise State's playing them close too all season long. Nothing there for Marlon Mack. It is Jared Alwan, one of the inside backers, stepping up, senior out of Cherry Hill and Camden Catholic, making the stop.
Yeah, penetration. We talked about it all night. And when you can get penetration like Avery Robinson did, makes it very difficult to move the ball.
Temple's one of the best tackle for loss teams in the country. They've got a half dozen of them tonight. Flowers, run pass option here, and a great job by Hassan Reddick with the speed. This is a next level guy, elite talent off the edge for Temple's D.
Absolutely, and Stephon Marshall did a really good job of sitting on the line of scrimmage and flattening it out. It was a run pass option, and he gave Flowers no place to go with the ball. So they're in a tough situation now on third down. You can see that Temple bunch is pumped.
Flowers taking a deep shot for Adams for separation. He nearly had it, but Delvin Randall stayed right with him. Boy, Adams nearly had that just at the last moment. Randall was there to tip it.
It looked like Randall might watch him catch it. Delvin was in a perfect position for it. He just tipped it, so he did get his hands on it. It looked worse than it was. Oof. Good play by Delvin Randall. He's made a couple of tremendous plays here late.
I think that was a great throw and a really good defensive play for a receiver who was in a good spot.
It was. And Adams nearly came up with a catch.
So Jahad Thomas steps back to return this John Hernandez punt. Pressure is there. It is deflected. It is blocked. It is run down to the sidelines for Temple by Mitchell Wilcox. Beg your pardon. Webb. Kirkwood. 89 Kirkwood. Offensive player was in on special teams. And the deflection gives Temple the ball with great field position.
You've got these big guys up front blocking. A lot of times you'll get through them. Jacob Martin getting back there, putting his hands on the ball, knocks it back. You cannot have special teams turnovers and block kicks on the road. Big play for Temple.
The junior out of Aurora, Colorado with the deflection sets him up at the 20 after Kirkwood scooped it up for Temple.
Now you got to go get your seven.
And can they cash in? That's been a question at times. They go with Thomas out of the eye this time, and he's got an alley to run through. First and goal, Temple. Harris finally caught up to him. 11 yards for Jahad Thomas.
Really good job of Bryant blocking downfield. You can just see these guys have a lot of good body language. They're feeling confident. Now they go back, keep their momentum, but slow the game down a little bit.
Harris went to the sideline. Looked like he was in some pain, so one of their best defensive players is not on the field right now for this first down and goal situation. There is Thomas, and Jahad Thomas lunging for the goal line. Touchdown, Temple.
It's an isolation play. Shark is leading up inside. The linebacker been getting tired of hit him in the face. So he jumps up inside. He was a backup. You can see this is going to be really, really close. We may get us a replay on this one.
Again, if the hand is on the ground, he's still alive on the play. If any other part of the arm goes down, that's when he would be ruled down. It looked like the ball had broken the plane by the time any other part besides the hand had touched the ground. It does not look like the knee went down, and it did not. So the ball broke the plane, and it should be and likely will be held up as a touchdown. Jahad Thomas, who scored at least two touchdowns in each of the last five games, the longest streak in the country right now, has his first of the night as it's confirmed as a score. What a sequence. And Boumery is able to bang it through. It's the largest lead of the night on either side at 11. First time either team has had a two-score lead. And Josh Martin started it all, getting the penetration.
And Adam, two things are happening here for coaching. Number one, you can't have the block punt. That'll get you beat faster than anything. And then after that, what you've got to do is you've got to stand up and make a stand. And the South Florida defense didn't get that done, and Temple took so much out of them in that first half with time of possession and beating them down. They looked a little tired on that drive, and when you have a sudden change, that defense has got to get excited about getting out there and make the stop. So now the staff at South Florida has to get this bunch to respond and get them a score.
Willie Taggart, the great offensive minds, has been pursued by a lot of people. You know, a year ago, this was an offense that wasn't clicking. About a third of the way through the season, they turned things around, had a great finish despite the loss of the bowl game to Willie's alma mater, Western Kentucky. And they're off to a red hot start this year. Out to the 25 will come Willie Taggart's offense, trailing by its largest deficit of 11. So an important game at the top of the American East. We've got two double header games, part of a doubleheader All four teams in the top 25 in the SEC West. Arkansas goes on the road. First SEC road game for the Hogs. And then Ole Miss and LSU from Baton Rouge tomorrow night. Joe Tessitore, Todd Blackledge, Holly Rowe will have the call of that opening game. Checking in with us. And Brett Bielema's big-time offense trying to stay on the field. And Austin Allen said... a lot of moxie. That's what Brett Bielema says about his quarterback. That's a different looking Arkansas offense than maybe last year. On first down, stretch play for Trayvon Sands. A lot of energy from Delvon Randall in the Temple defense. Not much on that play. You talked about that doubleheader in the SEC tomorrow night. Give me your thoughts on that game.
You start looking at those two. Well, first, Delvon Randall plays this play perfectly. He gets the guy off, sheds him away with his hands, steps back, keeps it contained, and turns it up inside. I think we got really good games tomorrow night. You go back to some of those Auburn-Arkansas games, they're so much fun to watch, and I can't wait to see the one in Death Valley.
Well, again, four OTs last year, Arkansas
they
and Auburn. They
did. It was unbelievable.
Marlon Mack, nothing there. Jared Alwan has made a couple of good plays there in the last two series. He's in the midst of things for the stop on the all-time leading South Florida rusher.
Now you got a hard play call if you're Willie Taggart, because you don't want your defense going right back out on the field with the momentum that they have with Temple's offense. So he's going to have to get something down the field here, probably in the passing game.
This might be the biggest third down play for Willie Taggart's offense tonight.
Looks like a three-man rush from Phil Snow's defense.
It is with a spy. And it still gets to Quinton Flowers. It's Praise Martin Ogwike with a big time stuff.
And that makes you so mad if you're the offensive coach at South Florida, because you cannot allow them to get there when you've got three rushing against five.
Martin Ogwike has had a huge night. He's got a blocked extra point in this game. He's got three tackles for loss and now a sack. And that'll take us to the end of quarter number three. South Florida has been the team to dominate second halves of their six wins so far this year. But Temple is showing life at home, looking for one of those big wins in conference play. The top two teams in the East have not disappointed through three in Philly. Largest lead of the game is 11 right now for Temple against 6-1 South Florida, which is hoping to crack the top 25, stay in the mix of the major teams that are playing well out of the group of five conferences. The Temple Owls have gotten it done at both ends of the field so far tonight. Matt Rhule's teams over the last 3 years, if they run for 145 or more, they're 14-2, and they've run for 235 tonight. Here is Jahad Thomas, and a good job in coverage for South Florida by Nico Sautel, shutting it down after a short return.
Adam, they're averaging 7.6 yards per carry tonight. And this is such a critical drive, because South Florida's defense can't afford to let Temple take a lot of time off the clock and take it down for a touchdown. They've got to step up and get a stop right here. And there's a lot more momentum on the Temple side than there is the South Florida side.
Raquel Armstrong will start this drive in the backfield. He of two touchdowns tonight, including the longest Temple offensive play from scrimmage this year of 76 yards. And Nick Sharga is the fullback, who has been impactful to say the least tonight.
Yeah, those running backs ought to adopt him. Take him to dinner a lot.
He's out there lead blocking again. Helps open up the Armstead hole, and Raquel Armstead is having one of the best nights of his collegiate career. Hassan Child shouldered him out, but not before he snatched up 19 more.
All of our fans will look at Sharga, number four at fullback. The corners aren't even taking him on anymore. They're trying to duck and get down and get out of his way, and I don't blame them. 6'2", 240 pounds coming at you all night. You get tired of seeing him.
And he's playing hurt, too.
Yeah, he's got a torn ACL.
Takes on the corner that time again, and Armstead leaps over both of them. And with that head of steam, gets right back towards the sticks as Jamon Thomas was there on the stop. Let's see where the knee went down and where the ball was in relation to it, according to the officials, and about a yard shot.
And Sharka gets up. and he's going to try to get him another one. So once again, on the corner. Little counterplay, bouncing it outside. Sharga knocks the corner down. He gets back up, and he's going to get him another one.
Career high night for Armstead, and that second effort may have gotten into the sticks, but Daniel Awalake, the senior out of Lakeland, Florida, was there and stopped that forward progress right at the line of scrimmage.
And if you're Temple now, you don't care. You're wanting every tick of that clock to be gone. So if it's third down and short, you've still got two opportunities to make it. Armstead's a special player, 205 pounds. What a night he's had. We talked about yards after contact. We didn't know that he had the speed to outrun the South Florida secondary when he gets in the open like he has twice tonight.
This is an important third down for Temple's offense and for South Florida's defense. They might be in field goal range right now, the Owls, and they go right back to Sharga for the second time tonight. He moves the chains on a third and short situation. Cecil Cherry was there for a big hit, but Sharga charges for the first.
Every now and then, you got to give Sharga a little treat.
He called it a treat.
It's just
right.
A treat. It's like giving your puppy a little pat on the head there. Sharga, we're going to let you carry it every 15, 20 times because you're blocking so well.
21 first downs, and it feels like Sharga's been involved on just about all of them.
And you said we've never talked about a fullback as much as we're talking about this young man tonight.
It just feels like a lost art playing that position, even having that position of the offense. This is Thomas trying to bounce to the outside and beat that South Florida pursuit. That's a big play to push him back to the 35. Now you're kind of outside field goal range, so if you have a stagnant drive, you're going to be in a tough spot here if you're Temple. That's a good play by Sanchez and Harris.
Well, I was going to say, somebody in South Florida's got to step up or they're going to get beat. So they're two older linebackers
that are
experienced, and their leaders on defense just did that. And this is not Temple's ball of wax right here. This is not their wheelhouse. They don't like long yardage.
Yep. Bryant is at the bottom of the formation. He's been the guy on those long situations on pass plays. Thomas bear claws forward to the 31. And it'll still be third down and long coming up here.
That's a really good tackle by Khalid McGee. He's a guy that's kind of that, he's a blitzer, but he's also the hybrid guy that can play nickel. He can play safety linebacker, either one, but he blitzes a lot. He made the play. So they've really had two tackles for loss here, or short yardage. So you've put Temple in a tough spot. They want to be smart here. I think we probably see draw screen. We're not going to see something down the field in my estimation.
Again, it's a two-score game right now, and you're trying to work clock.
And you've got a kicker that's been successful.
If they can get a few yards here, they can get into that range. And Matt Rhule's going to call a timeout.
First charge, timeout.
I think he saw him getting ready to come after him with a blitz. So I think he just said, hey, let's back away and let's think about this one. Big play.
Philadelphia's own Ed Sveda hands me a stat that says 264 rushing yards is the second most under Matt Rhule for a Temple team. Nick Sharga is a big reason why they put that together.
He is the reason. He isolates the linebackers and knocks them out. But you're Johnny Ward. You're at 183 pounds trying to come up and take on 240. No chance. He's got no chance. So he has been the difference in this ball game offensively because he is opening up holes inside and outside. And as we said, this young man's also got a slight tear in his ACL. A lot of kids wouldn't even be playing, and he didn't even go through preseason camp because he was hurt.
So on third down and long here, they're pretty much in field goal range for Aaron Boumery, who's made from 47 in his young career, but they'd like to make it a little easier. Walker will find Thomas, and he'll squirt forward to the 24. Good play by Sanchez, but this does make the kick a lot easier. And Molly, the conditions are getting a little bit worse on the field, but may not really faze Boumery.
Yeah, Adam, it's starting to rain a little bit more here on the field, but Boumery was hitting field goals from beyond the 50 in pregame warmups, and a member of Temple staff told me that range isn't an issue. He can kick up to 60 yards, but sometimes he struggles with his accuracy, guys.
Okay, so as you get a little bit further away, that's when things get a little hairier. Again, we said 47 against UCF last week. He's been good from beyond 30 tonight. And this one with another good leg. Accuracy, no issue there from 41. And Temple continues to tack on, and they've made it a two-full touchdown game. No Austin Jones, no problem. The freshman from Phillipsburg stepping right in, and Boom Boom has done it thrice tonight. 37-23 Owls. Let's take a look at tonight's backstage pass, and when you're at the home of the Temple Owls, you got to see the owl. Stella is a great horned owl who began her career as Temple's live mascot just 3 years ago. She's only about 2 feet tall, pretty small. You would think they're a little bigger, and it's only 3 pounds, but spread the wings, it's 5 feet in terms of the wingspan for Stella. And with those big talons, she can crush about 28 pounds of force in those talons. Originally from Washington State. She's got a boyfriend. So all you birds watching at home, watch out. Sherlock is gonna be on you on that. It's part of our backstage pass tonight. Gorgeous creature.
Looks pretty focused.
Locked in.
Locked in you for the last 10
Mac,
minutes.
Mac, you and Stella, I'm telling you. Same look. Rodney Adams will take a knee. South Florida down, still by 2 scores, but 2 full touchdowns now. And they came in with this offense on fire. A team that has the longest streak in the country with 200 plus rush yards, the longest streak in the country with at least 440 total yards, and the longest streak in the country of at least 35 or more points. So far, they have been held in check in all three categories by a Temple defense that lost 7 starters from last year, 3 to the NFL, and has had injuries all season long.
But that graphic also tells us they can score so quickly. This game is not over.
And if it's up to Quentin Flowers, he's going to make sure he does everything in his power to keep this close. Off play action, and they're going to take a shot down the middle for Adams. And Rodney Adams in traffic is going to hold on somehow inside of Temple territory at the 45. 2 defenders around him, and he would not be denied, the senior out of St. Petersburg.
And he was covered like a blanket. Randall did everything he could do but knock the ball down.
Well, they've had a nice battle tonight, haven't they?
They really have.
Back to throw again. Flowers, soft touch behind Adams, but he makes the adjustment. And Rodney Adams, who tonight has moved into second place all time in South Florida history in receiving yardage, is doing work on this drive. He'll come off the field here.
What did we just say? They can score so fast, and they're going fast.
Look where they are. 5 seconds ago, it feels like they were down at their own 25. Flowers, he can make magic happen with his feet. He'll take the conservative approach at the 29. Still pick up decent yardage on first down in front of Russell.
Boy, Temple's done such a great job of making him go up inside and then getting the pursuit for gang tackling. They didn't do that the first quarter. But these defensive ends have been slowed down, and they're doing a tremendous job of slowing him down. Reddick, one of the best in the country.
Again, spreading it out, twin stacks. On both sides on 2nd and 8. So the look, and it's Marlon Mack who gets a good block from a receiver. And Marlon Mack, just like that, to the house. And a huge touchdown for South Florida.
And that's what these guys can do. That's an inside dive. There's nothing there. It's played perfectly by Temple. Even runs into Flowers. He bounces outside, turns it up for the touchdown. That's how explosive these guys are. And those guys had really good blocks on the corner, too. You start looking at Solomon and Barr, that gets you in the end zone.
And we talked about that perimeter blocking, got it done there as Nadelman adds the extra point. He said it in a flash. They were at their own 25-yard line. And Marlon Mack goes 30 yards to cap off a 75-yard. You want to call it a drive if it only lasts 87 seconds? It's a one-score game.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Dickies, the world leader in performance workwear.
Okay, stop. Take it in.
This is pretty cool stuff. Tyler School of Art, one of Temple University's 17 schools and colleges, one of the nation's great fine arts schools. You get the blast program at Tyler, the 2nd ranked in the country. Philadelphia Real Center for Glass Arts. South Florida's offense going right back to its bread and butter. Big plays and putting it in Marlon Mack's hands. He goes 30 yards on a 75-yard drive that only went 87 seconds. All four drives that have ended in touchdowns for South Florida have been 203 or less. Jahad Thomas trying to switch fields. Looking for an alley. Good coverage that time downfield by Wilkins on the stop. And celebrating its 12th year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. To date, Allstate has contributed millions in scholarship funds. So Adam, Temple is up by seven, Mac. What do you want to see?
That's what you love about college football is the South Florida defense going to step up, stop them, get the ball back to their dynamic offense, or are we going to see a Temple drive to try to kill the last 8 minutes and 35 seconds and get points?
Toss play. It is Armstead. And Raquel Armstead, who is making good things happen on the ground tonight, gets stopped by Johnny Ward after three.
And we're going to see Temple's offense do what they've done throughout this game well. They're going to try to move it by running it. And you can see if you're sitting there and you've had Sharga knock you down all day, those guys are tired on defense. But we're going to see them try to keep the ball on the ground. I think we'll see some play action, probably move the quarterback at some point.
This will be Wildcat. Sharga is next to Isaiah Wright to help block. And he leads the way and goes out and beats up on the cornerback as he's been doing all night. And a good cutback by Isaiah Wright has the first down running into Harris.
And Isaiah Wright has deceptive speed. He doesn't look like he's going that fast, but he's making yards. And out of the Wildcat, he just a power sweep to the left. It's a stretch play. He plants his foot, turns up inside. It's over pursuit by the South Florida defense and gets his first down.
And again, Sharga stays in there now in that I formation.
They're taking their time.
Yep. Past the halfway point of the fourth quarter, up by seven. A fresh set of downs. They go back to the ground in Armstead. And a very impressive run out past the sticks, 10 and a half on the play.
We said it earlier, Adam, when we know we're going to run it and they know we're going to run it and they can't stop it, it's a great feeling. And that's what we're going to see with this Temple offense. It's the power play to the left. Nick Sharga again opens it up. You've got the big right guard pulling up inside. It is just an old I-formation power play. I'm sure as a linebacker at Penn State, Matt Rhule had to take that play on when Joe Paterno was running that I offense for many years. South Florida got to make a stop.
Armstead still in the game. He's the tail of the tandem who's run for 185. And Armstead will add to it. Fullwood was there on the stop along with Nigel Harris, but somehow he still churns out a half dozen more yards. 191. A career high by far for Raquel Armstead tonight. Last time that Temple had a 200-yard rusher, they had a 351-yard rusher. It was Montel Harris 4 years ago, part of a very impressive seven-touchdown night against Army.
You got to take care of the ball if you're Temple and the running backs. You got to strip one loose if you're South Florida. Time's wasting down here. You got to knock a ball loose or get a stop.
Jahad Thomas in the game. Sanchez was there at the 45. Big third down. It's about an even three coming up here for Temple. Obviously out of field goal range.
Willie Taggart for South Florida has done a good job of keeping all of his timeouts in his pocket. So he's still got three timeouts. But you can see that Matt Rhule's wanting to take his time and just kill this clock.
If they get a first down here, now do we see maybe Willie Taggart start to use those timeouts?
I don't think he uses them till the end. Okay. I always held them till the end.
Gotcha.
And I wanted to use them on offense if I could.
Temple tonight, 69% on third down. And out of the break, it was a stumble by Bryant. And he still almost got his hands on that ball cleanly. But you wonder, had he not stumbled out of that break, had he stayed on his feet, he might have gotten that first down catch. He was past the sticks.
And it was good coverage by Nigel Harris as he came out to the flat. But it was a perfect throw. He just slipped. It could have been intercepted as well because it's up in the air, and Johnny Ward could have yep. intercepted it. But this is a great stop for South Florida. Now you're giving your offense a chance to go get points and even this thing up.
D'Ernest Johnson is back to return. He's got a touchdown on a punt this year. And Matt Rhule was very wary of the return game for South Florida, knowing how dangerous they are.
They're not going to punt it to him.
That's a fair catch inside the 15 by Johnson. Good short punt by Starzik of 32. Five to go. Undefeated in conference, South Florida, down seven. What do you got, Bulls? Ohio State is the favorite going in to Happy Valley, but it's been a difficult spot for the Buckeyes to play over the years. Can Penn State deliver that knockout punch for Ohio State's playoff hopes? Saturday Night Football on ABC, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Also available on the ESPN app and Watch ESPN. Matt Rhule's alma mater will go at it tomorrow night against the number 2 ranked Buckeyes, and in a wild game himself tonight. 6 lead changes, top 2 teams in the Eastern Division of the American Conference, and it's been a big one tonight. Quinton Flowers back to work, long field in front of him, down by 7 with 5 to play. And a first down throw, a first down shot down the sideline, and looking for Adams. Hairston was hip for hip with him, and it's incomplete, second down. Both go tumbling out of bounds together.
You can see these guys are going back and forth. Good job by Hairston forcing him out of bounds. I do know if I was on the South Florida sideline, I'd probably be screaming.
That did feel like a catchable ball.
I'd lose my voice.
Yeah, a little, just about a few feet inside that white chalk. So I thought maybe that could be considered catchable. Gave him incidental contact and no call. Second down. Unbalanced look here, and they run to the stronger side with Mack. Great pursuit on defense for Temple by Jared Alwan, who's made some big plays here in the second half for the Temple defense.
I'm just really impressed by what Bill Snow did after the first quarter to flatten all the plays out for South Florida and make them run sideways and trying to keep leverage from outside and making them turn up. Contain and leverage. That's what you have to do against the option and speed like these guys have got. Make them run sideways. Talking about a huge third down.
And it doesn't. 6 of 12 tonight. Flowers is going to have to go a long way to make this happen. Downfield, and what is the ruling on the sidelines with McCants? Will it be ruled a catch at the 30? There is also a penalty marker at the 20.
Ineligible receiver downfield. Offense, number 77. 5-yard penalty. They're down.
Well, it's a moot point anyway. Marcus Norman got called for ineligible man downfield. If you are beyond 3 yards of the line of scrimmage when the ball is released, that is the key. Then it is ineligible man downfield, tagged against the redshirt freshman.
Yeah, young guy just made a mistake.
On the field,
well,
it was a catch.
But Quinton Flowers is running around so much.
Start on my ready.
That's what makes that difficult, and you see that a lot with the run-pass option teams.
It does. You're not sure where they are, but momentum definitely with Temple now.
And it was ruled a completion, so had that penalty not been there, that would have been a first down on 3rd and 12.
And what a play by Flowers.
Yeah.
He gets up inside. They've contained him. He bounces back outside, keeps his eyes downfield, and completes the ball. Now you've got to be smart and not turn it over, because you've still got a little time because of your 3 timeouts.
4:05 to go. 3rd down and 17. Just a 3-man rush with a spy. Flowers in traffic. Flag thrown. Still on his feet, Quinton Flowers looking downfield. He's going to take off, diving towards the sticks. We'll have to check the flag, and if it's a holding penalty in the end zone, it's going to be a safety. 3:42 to play here. And boy, Quinton Flowers went down, and he is still not up. Matt Rhule is talking with our lead official, Todd LaPenta, and Flowers is still on the deck. So much to sort out with 2 markers flying in. Again, if it's a holding penalty in the end zone, negate the run and call it a safety for Temple.
And if it's a safety, it's a killer, because then you have to punt or kick off to Temple.
With a 2-score lead, because it makes it a 9-point game.
and a team you're having trouble getting off the boundary.
Yeah. Right now, the biggest concern for South Florida might be with Quinton Flowers. And good to see him back up on his feet. And while it is gingerly, he is jogging back towards his own sideline.
And he has to come out for a play regardless.
And holding. Stop the clock for him.
Offense, number 77. After this is the goal, they're down.
So it is a holding penalty, but not in the end zone here against Norman. He was the right tackle. So a couple of things to sort out here. So watch the top of your screen of that line, 77. And holding penalty outside the end zone as it was ruled against Praise Martin Ogwikwe. And now the other thing to sort out with Flowers diving ahead and getting hurt on the play. You saw him pull up lame, clutching towards his left hamstring. So he comes off to the sideline, and on third down, and the line to gain at the 23, the redshirt freshman Brett Keene is in the game for the biggest snap of South Florida season right now. And now a penalty false marker start. Flies in for a false start.
Offense, number 77. Athos to goal, third down.
Might be a 3-inch penalty at that point, but 3:42 to go, and things are looking dicey for the Bulls and Willie Taggart's team.
On your backup quarterback, you don't want to throw an interception here and finish the game. You still can punt it and have an opportunity with three timeouts to stop them.
Three-man rush. Keene. Dangerous pass, interception, Temple. He threw it up for grabs, and it was picked off by Delvon Randall. First and goal, Temple. Flags come flying in. 3:23 to play. Second career pick for Randall, third rather for Randall. We have to sort out the flags for Todd LaPenta's crew here. What are they? When were they called? How will they affect the spot?
After the interception, personal foul, they can block below the waist on the passing team. Number 74, passes the goal, first down.
So Cameron Ruff gets tagged with a penalty as well, which will only set a better field position for the Owls on the first pass, on the first snap for Brett Keene tonight. It's a pick.
The young guy just threw it up down the middle. He couldn't do that. You can take the sack outside of the end zone. You can throw it out. But Delvon Randall's played a heck of a game tonight. He has made a lot of great plays on the defensive side.
Quinton Flowers. Heart-wrenching on the sidelines for him. Matt Rhule coming up with a clutch play from his defense. And Temple is on the doorstep of maybe knocking South Florida from the ranks of the conference unbeatens. Willie Taggart is on the way.
South Florida.
And you heard that from Todd LaPenta as well. Sideline warning for Willie Taggart and the South Florida Bulls now.
Those always come at the worst time.
My goodness.
Coaches are mad and you tell them to back up. Now you've got to make the stop here. Got to knock a ball loose. Do something.
Nope. Touchdown, Thomas. Temple has taken a two-score lead with 3:17 to go. Guess who was on the block? The guy we highlighted at the top, there's a reason we talked about the fullback in this offense in particular. And he opened it up for Thomas to extend that two-touchdown streak. Now a half dozen games with at least two scores for Jahad Thomas. Boomeri on for the extra points. And it is a two-touchdown lead for Temple. 3:17 to play. South Florida not out of this by any means, but this was a big score with Sharga leading the way.
Unbalanced line. You're going to see him run to the left, follow number four. It's a little counter power, and he just comes right up and knocks Fullwood right back out of the way for the hole. Easy score by Thomas. This young man's had one special night, and he's made those tailbacks, who are really good players, look even better tonight.
The toughness that he has shown, the quirky nature of his background, comes from a really big family. The guys seem to really like this guy. Jahad Thomas called him the hardest working player on the team, and you can see why. He's put in the dirty work tonight to open things up for four rushing touchdowns between Thomas and Armstead. The balance in the backfield has a lot to do with Sharga leading the way for both guys.
One of 11 children in his household. Yep. Goes to West Virginia Wesley and transfers. Won't give him a scholarship. He's a scout team defensive end. What a message for all those young guys out there that aren't getting the attention they think they could get. Go make sure you get that attention.
Now let's not write South Florida's obituary for this game just yet, because we've talked about their quick scoring drives. All their four touchdown drives have come in 2 minutes or less. So there is still 3:17 for Willie Taggart. He's probably still licking his chops going, hey, give us the ball, we got a shot.
Now, we won a lot of games at Texas when there was less time than this left and you were down by 14. So this game is definitely not over.
Man on the ball for Boumery to kick it away. This is a dangerous return man, Rodney Adams from the one. Seeking space, flag is thrown. Three of them come flying in now. One from one side of the field, one from the other, and one from the top side of the field as well, with 3:10 to go.
During the return, legal block in the back, receiving team, number 28, half this is the goal, first down.
Things could get weird in the final few minutes. We've got another game coming up as well. We've got Adnan Virk in the studio.
All right, Adam, perhaps some more oddities on the way. Davis Webb and Cal taking an Oregon Webb tie for third in the FBS with 22 touchdown passes, third in the FBS with 376 passing yards per game. So Oregon and Cal coming up next on ESPN. And over on ESPN2, Donnell Pumphrey averaging 207 yards from scrimmage, most in the FBS. He and San Diego State taking on San Jose State. That game will be on ESPN2. Adam?
Adnan, it's still Brett Keene in the game, and it's Brett Keene down to the deck. Roman Deloach comes up with the sack. Keene is hurt. It is a safety for Temple, and they've got a 16-point lead.
What a story about Deloach. He's a guy that plays tight end. He plays defensive end. In fact, they got mad at him on offense. They moved him over to scout team defensive end. He started rushing the passer, so they said, hey, we might let you do this, and now he's one of the better two-way players in the country.
He had a 34-yard fumble recovery for a touchdown against SMU earlier this season. And then he almost had an offensive touchdown in that same game. He got all the way out to the one-yard line before he was touched down. He had a big defensive game against UCF, 3 tackles for loss, 2 sacks, and a forced fumble as well. He's a tremendous story. Self-proclaimed mama's boy who actually lost his mother, Wanda, to colon cancer 2.5 years ago. Before every game, he always says a quick prayer, and anytime he gets into the end zone on the offensive end, he always looks up to the sky and points up, says that's who he plays for, Wanda, his late mother. An incredible story, a guy who's turned into a great two-way Temple player. And that sack with the safety makes it a 16-point game with a free kick coming.
And he didn't give them much for a long time, and they said the light finally came on. And he is really a good football player for them now on both sides of the field.
Again, still a 2-score game, but the problem is here that South Florida has to give the ball up. And Brett Keene was out there for a second consecutive play after Temple had taken over on offense. And you can only imagine how frustrated Quinton Flowers is sitting on the sidelines right now. Fake it one way, onside kick, short kick here. And it is grabbed by Temple's Roman Deloach. And Temple's got the football with 3 minutes to play. SEC West top 25 doubleheader Saturday on ESPN. You've got Arkansas and Auburn, a 4 overtime game a year ago. Then college football finale, Ole Miss and LSU from Baton Rouge. Both games on ESPN, the ESPN app, and watch ESPN as well. Huge games tomorrow night in the SEC West. Got a couple of notes from that primetime crew. Brett Bielema told Todd Blackledge, Charlie Rowe, and Joe Tess, Austin Allen's moxie is unparalleled. So we talk about the running game, but Austin Allen has a really good streak right now, getting multiple touchdowns through the air the last 7 games.
Yeah, he's fun to watch, and nobody's excited about playing Chad Kelly.
Man, you want to talk about a stud who's done well against big-time opponents. Armstead continues his career night and somehow finds the sticks. down to the 26-yard line, dragging defenders with him. And this is the type of night that Matt Rhule had been waiting for against a high-quality opponent late in the game, making the plays on both sides of the ball to try to put out a win.
Slow down, take care of the ball. 201 yards rushing tonight. Just don't turn it over. If you're South Florida, you've got to knock a ball loose. Strip it loose. Temple's going to waste as much of this time as they can.
And again, still three timeouts with which to work. You would imagine it's going to force Willie Taggart's hand at some point soon. If Armstead doesn't keep running through the defense, boy, what a night for Armstead. Godwin finally makes the stop, and there's a timeout.
First charge timeout, South Florida. This will be a 30-second timeout.
The slashing sophomore from Millville, New Jersey, with over 200 yards tonight on the ground.
Now we said a guy that could run with it for yards after contact, and he has done that. But he also has the speed to break the long one. His vision's good. This young man has really come into his own tonight, and he's been a lot of fun to watch. He's been the difference in this ball game, running behind the great blocks of Nick Sharkey.
159 against SMU was his previous career high. He's blown past that by 50. And again, when Matt Rhule's teams have run the ball effectively, they've won games. They're going to move, likely, if they finish this out, to 15-2 over the last three seasons when they rush for at least 145. We've got way more than 145 tonight. That's good penetration by South Florida's Kevin Bronson, and now South Florida will lose a second timeout.
And Matt Rhule told us he talked to his team all week about being tough because last year.
Timeout. Please reset the game clock to 2 minutes and 15 seconds.
Last year, South Florida was much more physical than his team, so we heard Temple tough. We heard that we've got to be more physical than these guys, and we heard it from everybody we talked to yesterday.
44-23 win.
Thank you.
For South Florida against a ranked Temple team last year. Third down and short coming up, and don't forget tomorrow, the site of game day for the 13th time is Tuscaloosa, Alabama, as they will get you set for Texas A&M and Alabama. And remember, A&M has made things tough at times on Alabama. Jalen Hurts becoming a stud, and watch for number 15, all right? Defensive end, he's going to be a stud in the NFL. Live from Tuscaloosa, they'll set you up for that game and the entire slate at 9 a.m. Eastern time. Third down and short, they go to Sharga again, and for the third time tonight, he's converted on those third and shorts. So we approach 2 minutes to play in a two-score game.
Yes, A&M's got two really good defensive ends. Deshaun Hall's another
very good on the other side.
They're both NFL guys. They really hurt Tennessee with the zone read play on offense. Alabama really hurt Tennessee with the zone read play on offense. What's going to happen with that zone read tomorrow?
Who's going to run it better? Whose defensive ends are going to be sharper on those reads? That's going to be a big deal tomorrow.
John Chavis, the defensive coordinator at A&M, coached against Alabama and all those LSU-Alabama games.
Yes, sir.
So he'll be ready. Should be a good one. Trevor Knight beats Alabama a few years ago when he's at Oklahoma in the bowl game.
Yep, that was in the Sugar Bowl, that blowout game. Here is Jahad Thomas on the move, still trying to churn away these seconds. South Florida has one more timeout.
Final charge, timeout.
Again, with the standings the way they are, as tight as they are, this was a difficult stretch for South Florida. They've got this game tonight, then they've got Navy, then they've got Memphis. And meanwhile, Temple, assuming they close this one out, you're one win away against a favorable schedule to become bowl eligible and go to a bowl game in back-to-back years for the first time ever. And Temple's been playing football since 1894.
Well, and barring a miracle, they're going to win tonight. And if you're South Florida, you got to get ready for Navy next week, so you can't hold your head down long. But you start looking at the Temple Owls, they have a chance in every other ball game this year to win.
They are the FPI favorite for the rest of their schedule. We'll see them in Storrs, Connecticut against UConn on November the 4th on ESPN2. Matt Rhule's team in victory formation. Hey, top two teams in the league, they're both going to be 3-1, and this gives the tiebreak to the Temple Owls. And I don't know if a lot of people were thinking Temple early in this season based on a couple of tough losses, but this was still a team that was picked behind South Florida as second in the preseason poll in the East, and they're right in the thick of things. They're going to be in first place at the end of this night for the top spot to try to make it back to the conference title game.
So young, especially on defense. They lost a lot of players that along with their youth. This football team's getting better each week.
Got to turn off as much clock as possible. They'll still be above 40 seconds. Might have to take one more snap and run out a second or two to close this thing out. Don't forget Oregon and Cal. We've got American Conference before Pac-12 after dark. That's coming up next. Both teams coming off the bye. Things could get goofy. Oregon hasn't lost five straight in about two decades. And Cal with Davis Webb trying to make big things happen. Alan Beswick, Mike Bellotti, Chris Budden will have the call in moments.
What a great win for Temple.
Huge for Matt Rhule.
And don't count South Florida out.
Nope.
This loss and the only loss to Florida State. They're already thinking about Navy. I can promise you that.
Remember,
be a great one next Friday night.
Absolutely, my friend. We'll be there for it. Navy and South Florida. Remember in 2015 when everybody was looking at the American Conference as a legitimate threat?
Temple.
A lot of teams here in this conference are going to be scary down the stretch. 1 second left. Timeout has to be used here. They have to churn out that final second. But Temple, South Florida, Navy, Houston in this conference alone, along with Boise State and Western Michigan, and the great group of five teams that are hunting to be the top-ranked conference champion out of the group of five. All those teams are in the mix for it. The Temple Owls knock South Florida from the ranks of the unbeaten in conference play. Both teams are 3-1 in conference. Ramali McGrath, Mac Brown, Adam Amin, sing so long from Philly. Cross country, Cal, Oregon. Take it away, guys.